In this film, we will visit some of the largest megachurches in the United States. We will also examine the methodology of celebrity pastors to determine whether or not their practices are biblical or worldly. We ask the viewer to humbly and prayerfully consider the information presented hereafter in its entirety in order to make a sound judgment about the end results and fruit of popular church growth practices. We will first consider the pastor and author Rick Warren. He is the founder and senior pastor of Saddleback Church, an evangelical megachurch located in Lake Forest, California, currently the sixth largest church in the United States. Warren has been invited to speak at national and international forums, including the United Nations, the World Economic Forum in Davos, the African Union, the Council on Foreign Relations, Harvard's Kennedy School of Government, TED, and Time's Global Health Summit. He was named one of America's top 25 leaders by U.S. News and World Report. Warren was named by Time Magazine as one of 15 world leaders who mattered most in 2004. He is the builder of the Purpose-Driven Network, a global alliance of pastors from 162 countries and hundreds of denominations who have been trained to be purpose-driven churches. Founder of Pastors.com, a bi-weekly newsletter that is sent to more than 100,000 pastors and ministry leaders, and author of The Purpose-Driven Life. According to a Barna survey, the book has also been most identified by American pastors and ministers as the most influential book on their lives and ministries.
When I wrote the book, The Purpose-Driven Life, and you asked about selfishness, the opening sentence of The Purpose-Driven Life is four words: it's not about you. That is the most counterculture statement you can make. And it became the best-selling book in English in world history. It's next to the Bible, it's the best-selling book, and it's the most translated book next to the Bible, over 100 languages.
As a philanthropist, Rick Warren is measurably improving people's lives around the world through his peace plan and other humanitarian works.
It will change the world.
He claims to be ushering in a new reformation in the church. But what is this new reform all about? Rick Warren's book, The Purpose-Driven Life, and his Saddleback Church have profound global influence. Saddleback has recently launched campuses in 12 strategic gateway cities around the world for their proximity to the final 3,800 people groups that still do not have a church. These global campuses, while headed by pastors already linked to local culture, will feature live worship and video or satellite feed messages from Warren. Because of this global influence, his ministry deserves serious scrutiny, especially when he receives so much criticism for preaching a watered-down and superficial version of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
In his Purpose-Driven Life book, I just simply compared what Rick Warren was teaching against the Scripture, line by line, precept by precept.
My major concern with that book is that it is the way it omits the gospel.
He has an agenda to teach, and often if that agenda can't actually be found in the Bible, he'll go to a paraphrase such as The Message, and he'll find something in The Message or another paraphrase that says something similar to what he wants to teach.
I mean, obviously, as you read the book, he uses dozens of different Bible translations, and he'll skip from version to version based on what sort of spin he wants to put on the text.
He chooses what fits his program, and as a result, you don't get convicted when you're listening to Rick Warren.
In his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, on page 58, Warren essentially describes the gospel message as believe and receive. He writes, "Right now, God is inviting you to live for His glory by fulfilling the purposes He made for you. Real life begins by committing yourself completely to Jesus Christ. If you are not sure you have done this, all you have to do is believe and receive. Wherever you are reading this, I invite you to bow your head and quietly whisper the prayer that will change your eternity. Jesus, I believe in you and receive you. Go ahead. If you sincerely meant that prayer, congratulations. Welcome to the family of God. Notice in Rick Warren's version of the gospel presented in The Purpose-Driven Life, there is no mention of repentance from sin. Without repentance, there is no forgiveness. The gospel message presented in the Bible clearly requires repentance from sin and faith in Christ as inseparable for a person's salvation. While Warren defines repentance as a mental shift and to change your mind, repentance is most importantly turning from sin itself and turning to God. Jesus did not come to save people in their sins, but to save them from their sins. He did not come in order that you might continue in sin and escape the penalty, but so that you would be saved from the sins themselves.
Rick Warren is very dangerous, and here's the reason why. The guy is actually a genius, but he's using his genius in a way that harms churches. We meant to meet Rick Warren in person because he wanted to meet his critics and find out why in the world we're against him. So I think the idea was, well, let's bring some of our critics out here, and once they meet me, they'll decide I'm okay. But what I did was I pleaded with him to start preaching the gospel. And I said, let me explain what I mean by the gospel. Then I preached the gospel to him, the person of Christ, the person and work of Jesus Christ. And of course, it fell on deaf ears.
Rick Warren spoke at TED. I mean, here he is with an audience of very influential people, with an opportunity to say anything he wanted to say. And that would be the opportunity, really, to give the gospel. And he didn't do it. He gave them a message of works, really. He said, God likes it when you be you. You know, you're wired to do a certain thing, and you need to find out, look at your shape and do it.
In the book, I talk about how you're wired to do certain things. You're shaped with little acrostic, spiritual gifts, heart, ability, personality, and experiences. These things shape you. And if you want to know what you ought to be doing with your life, you need to look at your shape. What am I wired to do? Why would God wire you to do something and then have you do it? If you're wired to be an anthropologist, you be an anthropologist. If you're wired to be an undersea explorer, you be an undersea explorer. If you're wired to make deals, you make deals. If you're wired to paint, you paint. Did you know that God smiles when you be you? And when you write a book that the first sentence of the book is, it's not about you, then when all of a sudden it becomes the best-selling book in history, you got to figure, well, I guess it's not about me. And that's kind of a no-brainer. So what is it for?
Yeah, he starts his book out, of course. It's not about you. But if that sentence weren't there and you read the book, you'd think it is about you, you know. And when he gave that talk to the TED audience, it was about him. It was all about him and what he and his wife did with his money.
So we gave it all back to the back. And then we set up three foundations working on some of the major problems of the world: illiteracy, poverty, pandemic diseases, particularly HIV/AIDS, and set up these three foundations and put the money into that. The last thing we did is we became what I call reverse tithers.
Practically everything he said came across as a boast. You know, you listen to that lecture, and he had about 20 minutes there to say anything he wanted. And I would guess probably 18 and a half of the 20 minutes were all about him. He really didn't mention Christ a single time in that TED lecture. He mentioned the name of Jesus because he described an incident where a woman came and showed him a piece of paper and said she could see the face of Jesus in it. But he basically brushed her off and rolled his eyes and said, you know, what a kook.
A lady came up to me the other day and she had a white piece of paper. Michael, you like this one. And she said, what do you see in it? And I looked in and I said, well, I don't see anything. And she goes, well, I see Jesus, and started crying and left. I'm going, okay, you know, fine. good for you.
He had nothing whatsoever to say about Jesus. Apparently, he doesn't even see Jesus in Scripture, because that's not what he talks about when he gets the opportunity.
So the good life is not about looking good, feeling good, or having the goods. It's about being good and doing good. The bottom line is God gets pleasure watching you be you. Why? He made you. And when you do what you were made to do, he goes, that's my boy. That's my girl. You're using the talent and the ability that I gave you. So my advice to you is look at what's in your hand, your identity, your influence, your income, and say, it's not about me. It's about making the world a better place. Thank you.
I look at that and I think this sort of epitomizes the whole seeker-sensitive approach. And you know, not just to pick on Rick Warren, but he is the most visible and influential of the seeker-sensitive guys. And as I listen to him and watch him in these opportunities when he's on national TV or in a forum like TED or whatever, does he preach the gospel? And the answer is consistently, no, he doesn't. He didn't put it in his book. He doesn't preach it when he has the microphone. And that troubles me. It shows that there's something seriously wrong with his perception of what the purpose of the church and his purpose as a minister really is.
What it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ is to say, I give as much of myself as I understand to as much of Jesus Christ as I understand at that moment. And then you keep growing in it.
In his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, and in his video series, 40 Days of Purpose, he does not give a clear gospel. As a matter of fact, the gospel that he does give is very weak and very watered down. And this is alarming to people, many of them who went through the series, who do not know Jesus Christ and don't know the true gospel. For example, in his video series, I want to read from this, the 40 Days of Purpose, Warren leads his listeners in a prayer.
Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? If you're not sure of this, maybe you've gone to church all your life, maybe you've never been in church. It doesn't matter. I'd like the privilege of leading you in a prayer to settle this issue, that you are connected to Christ. So let's bow our heads together. I'm going to pray a prayer, and you can follow it silently in your mind. Let's pray.
Now, it needs to be kept in mind that at this point, Warren has talked virtually nothing about the cross, about the crucifixion, about the fact that we're sinners, about our need for salvation, about what Jesus did for us. Virtually nothing that a person who has very little knowledge of the Bible should know before they commit their life to Jesus Christ. And so, but at the end of the first session in his video series, he asks the people to pray this prayer at the end of that series. He says, I want you to repeat after me. Dear God, I want to know your purpose for my life.
Dear God, I want to know your purpose for my life. I don't want to waste the rest of my life on wrong things. Today, I want to take the first step in preparing for eternity by getting to know you. Jesus Christ, I don't understand it all, but as much as I know how, I want to open up my life to you. I ask you to come into my life and make yourself real to me. And use this series in my life to help me know what you made me for. Thank you. Amen. Now, if you just prayed that prayer for the very first time, I want to congratulate you. You've just become a part of the family of God.
That is deeply disturbing to me. Because again, he mentions nothing here about our need for a Savior, the fact that we're sinners, the fact that we're under the wrath and judgment of God, the fact that Christ died in our place, the need for repentance, the need for faith. None of these things and many others were mentioned prior to this prayer. And yet the prayer is about finding your purpose in life. Lord, I want to find my purpose in life, and I want you to help me find my purpose in life. And if you'll help me find my purpose in life, then that's great. And then he says, after you prayed such a prayer, then congratulations, you're now become part of the family of God. Well, most likely, such people that would pray such a prayer have no concept of why Christ died for their sins, why they need a Savior, anything along that line. And therefore, they're praying a prayer to find purpose. They're not praying a prayer to find forgiveness from sin and to be made right with a holy God. And therefore, I think this series definitely underplays the gospel. It makes it very weak. It makes it very easy to believe without even understanding our need for salvation. And therefore, it is very alarming and very concerning that people could take this video series, read the book, pray a little prayer and think they're saved, when in reality they don't know the first thing about why Jesus Christ died for them.
I've seen Rick Warren in several venues where you desperately want someone who's going to preach the gospel. The TED Talk was one. He's been on Larry King and other network news programs where he's been questioned and interviewed about things like the meaning of life and what is our purpose as a human race. Great doorways through which you could drive a truckload of gospel truth, but I've never seen him actually take the bait. I've never actually seen him make the most of those opportunities and preach the gospel. The closest he came was when he told Alan Combs to give Jesus a 30-day money-back trial.
But what does it say for all those people who do not accept Christ as their personal Savior?
I'm saying that this is the perfect time to open their life, to give it a chance. I'd say give them a 60-day trial.
Even that notion that Jesus is someone you should give a try to, and if he doesn't do what you think he should or work the way you want him to, then you can just abandon him, I suppose. That's the way pagans think. That's not the gospel. That's not something a gospel preacher should ever say.
Is that yeah, okay. 60-day trial? Sounds like the book of the month.
See if he'll change your life. I dare you to try trusting Jesus for 60 days. Your money guaranteed back.
Really? Are you going to give me the money back?
Absolutely.
Rick Warren's flawed gospel is only a symptom of a greater sickness, the fruit of the church growth movement of which he is a part. This prevalent movement within evangelical Christianity can be identified by a philosophy of ministry intentionally designed to effect numerical growth. The seeker-sensitive label is often associated with these megachurches in the United States, where Christian messages are often accompanied by elaborate spectacles and elements drawn from secular pop culture, such as rock music and other forms of entertainment. Their methodologies are often more attentive to market strategy, business techniques, and demographics rather than biblical instruction. The church growth movement was founded by two people independently, Donald McGavran and Robert Schuller. Both men influenced Rick Warren. Rick Warren has readily pointed out that Donald McGavran brilliantly challenged the conventional wisdom of his day about what made churches grow. McGavran's 1955 book, The Bridges of God, cited in Warren's The Purpose-Driven Church, is said to have launched the church growth movement. McGavran later funded the Fuller School of World Missions and Institute of Church Growth, an organization further expanded by C. Peter Wagner. While Donald McGavran could be said to be the intellectual founder of the movement, Robert Schuller is its most notable popularizer. Robert Schuller followed in the footsteps of Norman Vincent Peale, pioneer of the theory of positive thinking, and most notably known for his book, The Power of Positive Thinking. In his book, Positive Imaging, The Powerful Way to Change Your Life, Peale mixes humanistic psychology with Christianity. Author George Mayer writes, "He is also the father of the self-help movement that formed the groundwork for the church growth movement. Peale formed perhaps the most dramatic and meaningful link between religion and psychology of any religious leader in history. It is this same approachable, therapeutic brand of religion that many megachurches, including Saddleback, put forward today. It is this kind of religion that is so appealing to the masses of unchurched men and women that Rick Warren hopes to reach." In the 1950s, Robert Schuller began to integrate the positive thinking philosophy of Norman Vincent Peale with business-oriented marketing strategies. Possibility thinking was Schuller's form of Peale's positive thinking. Schuller adapted church growth principles to his own theology of self-esteem, which lured Southern Californians into his church. In his own words, Schuller said, "Then I proceeded to spend about $50 for brochures. Hoping to impress unchurched people, I wrote to Dr. Norman Vincent Peale, who wrote back a marvelous statement with his permission to quote extensively, so I grabbed hold of his coattails." Eventually, Schuller built the glassy crystal cathedral and his multi-million-dollar television ministry. Author George Mayer not only explains that Norman Vincent Peale laid the foundation of the megachurch movement, but he also notes that it was Robert Schuller who helped create the effectiveness of the church growth movement on a national scale. Schuller boasts that two of his most famous students were Saddleback pastor Rick Warren and Willow Creek Community Church pastor Bill Hybels. Schuller states, "Think about it. In 1970, where could a pastor go to learn successful principles for personal, spiritual nourishment and church growth? There was not a single source except the sometimes cumbersome route through the denomination. Our institute has set a new and respected precedent. Alumni include Bill Hybels, Rick Warren, and many, many others who found the fundamental principles of success at our sessions, and the rest is church history." Mayer writes, "In the 1990s, following in the footsteps of Peale and Schuller, the leader of the next generation of church growth movement pastors emerged. That man was none other than Rick Warren." Rick Warren has publicly distanced himself from Robert Schuller and Norman Vincent Peale when he spoke to WorldNet Daily. "I've only met Robert Schuller twice, I believe. I've never had a one-on-one conversation with him, not once. So how do I even know him?"
He disavows Robert Schuller. Because when I was out there in person talking with him, he said, "Oh, Schuller's a heretic. I don't have anything to do with Schuller." And then so we said, "Well, I heard that you went to Schuller's church growth seminar," because, you know, that was written up in Christianity Today or somewhere. And he said, "Oh, I had won a contest at seminary, so that's where I had to go. I didn't really want to be there."
But no matter how much Rick Warren and his apologists try to create a greater rift from Schuller, the influence is undeniable. Rick Warren's own wife, Kay Warren, confesses that Schuller had a great impact on her husband. Christianity Today reported, "During his last year in seminary, he, Rick Warren, and Kay drove west to visit Robert Schuller's Institute for Church Growth. We had a very stony ride out to the conference," she says, "because such non-traditional ministry scared her to death. Schuller, though, won them over. He had a profound influence on Rick," Kay says. "We were captivated by his positive appeal to non-believers. I never looked back." So profound and life-changing was Warren's visit to Schuller's Institute. He imitated and adopted Schuller's positive appeal to non-believers. The article continues, "Imitating Schuller, Warren walked the then unincorporated but fast-growing town of Lake Forest, asking what kept people from going to church." It is not so much that Rick Warren became a proponent of Schuller's self-esteem preaching or New Age spirituality, but he did, like Schuller and Peale, set out to build a church that would appeal to unbelievers. Rick Warren writes, "Create a service that is intentionally designed for your members to bring their friends to, and make the service attractive, appealing, and relevant to the unchurched that your members are eager to share it with lost people they care about." Though Warren may not see eye to eye with Schuller's heretical doctrine, the Seeker Model Church was adopted by Warren following in the steps of Peale and Schuller. As Warren recalls the early days of building his church, he talked about going door to door, not with the gospel, but with the following pitch. "My name is Rick Warren. I'm not here to sell you anything. I'm not here to convert you. I'm not here to witness to you. I just want to ask you 3 or 4 questions. Question number 1, are you an active member of a local church of any kind of religion, synagogue, mosque, whatever? If they said yes, I said, 'Great, God bless you, keep going,' and I politely excused myself and went to the next home." Warren has sought out to build churches that appeal to those who don't believe in Christ. He admits, "I didn't want to color the survey with believers' opinions." Like Peale, Schuller, and Warren, Bill Hybels also designed his Sunday morning service at Willow Creek for unbelievers. We read that Hybels founded the church after surveying the community and designing Sunday morning services for non-believers. Bill Hybels also says, "Unchurched people today are the ultimate consumers. We may not like it, but for every sermon we preach, they're asking, 'Am I interested in that subject or not?' If they aren't, It doesn't matter how effective our delivery is, their minds will check out.
Well, I always thought that church was for churched people. The problem was I grew up and went to church and didn't understand the story of Jesus. And so years later, I really felt a burden to start a church that people who hadn't been in church would understand the story of Jesus.
What drove us wasn't so much about changing church as it was trying to figure out how we could engage unchurched people and unbelievers in our community in the local church. We were actually told that it wouldn't work. We were told that it wouldn't work because we were in the South and there's a church on every corner, and the last thing Atlanta, Georgia needed was another church. And we completely agreed. In fact, when we stood up in front of our first group of people on our launch night, I said, Atlanta doesn't need another church. But what Atlanta, Georgia needs is a different kind of church, a church where people feel free to invite their unchurched friends and family members. So that was the beginning of the journey for us. And we've been very successful in terms of counting people in numerically. And I think part of the reason was when we started, nobody else was doing this in our community. We set out to be seeker-focused. That is, the bottom line for us was to create a church that unchurched people loved to attend. Not simply a church that it was easy to invite someone to. We wanted to create environments, church environments, that unchurched people absolutely love to attend.
The thing we celebrate, it's not just salvation, it's bigger than that. It's unchurched people finding our church, finding their way in, navigating the complexity, and becoming followers of Jesus Christ.
But there is no such thing as church for the unchurched or church for non-believers. Rick Warren wrote the foreword to Dan Sutherland's book entitled Transitioning, Leading Your Church Through Change. The book is designed to show pastors how to transition their traditional church into a purpose-driven megachurch. In a church transition seminar, Sutherland redefined the church by repeating the famous line, "It's not about you," from Warren's book, The Purpose-Driven Life.
Church is so not about me. Would you say that? Church is so not about me. The people that God is most interested in on Sunday morning are the ones that are driving up and down this street and don't even know we're here. It's not about me. And it's not about you. So when somebody comes to me and says, "Dan, I really don't like the music," I say to them, "I need to apologize to you. I somehow have given you the impression that church is for you. And I don't know what I have done to give you that impression. But I really want you to hear it's not. And I know the music's a stretch for you. It's a stretch for me. But we're not here for the already convinced. We're here for the yet to know Christ crowd. And we've got to fish with the bait that they understand. So I hope that you can buy in to purpose over preference." Do you hear that phrase? Choose purpose over preference.
This is one of the foundational flaws within the megachurch methodology. While their model of church is intended for unbelievers, the New Testament church is for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. The church is about you, if you are a Christian. But there is no such thing as church for the unchurched. In 1 Corinthians 12, Paul describes the gifts of the Holy Spirit which are given for the common good of the church. Paul says to the church, "Now you are the body of Christ and members individually, and God has appointed these in the church, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that, miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, administrations, varieties of tongues." Note that these gifts are given in the church to Christians. God does not give the gifts of the Holy Spirit to unbelievers or the unchurched because they are, by definition, not part of the church. They are not a member of Christ's body, the church. Paul continues saying, "But he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church." Note that this gift is for the edification of the church, not unbelievers. Verse 5 says, I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets, that the church may receive edification. Spiritual gifts are given in the church for the edification of the church, not to unbelievers, nor for the edification of unbelievers. You cannot do church for the unchurched, because the unchurched are not part of the body of Christ. By definition, the church is not for them. In the book of Acts, the church sent evangelists out into the world rather than changing the church service to entertain the Romans. Rather than transforming the world through the gospel, these churches are conforming to the world. The Bible says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Perhaps we could understand these communities better if we stopped calling them churches.
If you know Jesus, I am sorry to break it to you. This church is not for you. Yeah, but I just gave my life to Christ last week at Elevation. Last week was the last week that Elevation Church existed for you.
The New Testament lays the groundwork for a plurality of church leadership rather than that of a single celebrity pastor. Celebrity pastor is not a biblical church office. Many church growth leaders have changed the definition of pastor in order to destroy barriers to church growth and have absolute authority over their organizations. For example, Rick Warren says, "You must change the primary role of the pastor from minister to leader." When asked, "Should we stop talking about pastors as shepherds?" Andy Stanley responded, "Absolutely. That word needs to go away. It was culturally relevant in the time of Jesus, but it's not culturally relevant anymore. Nothing works in our culture with that model except this sense of the gentle pastoral care. Obviously, that is a face of church ministry, but that's not leadership." But the New Testament prescribes a plurality of church leadership rather than that of a single celebrity pastor. The Bible speaks of pastors, elders, bishops, or overseers, all referring to the same office. Elders are also called pastors and teachers, and bishops or overseers. The Greek word episkopos is translated as bishop and overseer in the context of the role of pastor or shepherd. Peter uses the term synonymously with the Greek word poimen, which is elsewhere translated as shepherd or pastor. "For you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls." Pastors are also referred to as elders with the Greek word presbyteros, which Peter describes as the role of pastors when he says, "The elders who are among you I exhort, I, who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers." Additionally, Paul uses the terms elders, presbyteros, and bishops, episkopos, interchangeably. "For this reason I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are lacking, and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. For a bishop must be blameless, as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money." Paul the Apostle encourages the elders at Ephesus in their pastoral and shepherding task when he says, "Therefore take heed to yourselves and to all the flock, among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God which he purchased with his own blood." Notice Paul spoke about the plurality of overseers to shepherd or pastor the church. The same word for overseer is also translated as bishop when Paul again addresses a plurality of bishops to the church at Philippi. Paul and Timothy, bondservants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, with the bishops and deacons. Notice this office is listed alongside a plurality of deacons. The qualifications of elders and deacons is found in the pastoral epistles in 1 Timothy 3, 1-13 and Titus 1, 5-9. Therefore, the two ongoing offices for the management and care of the New Testament church are elders and deacons, both plural and not singular, as in the example of the celebrity pastor of the church growth model. Not only is the office of celebrity pastor an innovation of church growth, but the scriptures speak of church leadership in a distinctly different way, not as lording over God's flock. Vision casting becomes the common practice of the pastor to lead the church, and the congregation becomes fully accountable and completely loyal to the leader to fulfill his vision.
So Stephen and I had this conversation one day. All right, we're done. We're leaving Shelby. We're going to go start this church. And so, of course, he needs somebody to, like, be his right-hand man, because for all of the strengths that he has that are spiritual and hearing from God and getting a vision and casting that vision, he knew that he needed help in actually carrying out this vision.
Hi, my name is Mark Batterson. I serve as lead pastor of National Community Church in Washington, D.C. Thanks for taking a couple of minutes, letting me hang out with you. We're going to talk for a few minutes about vision casting. I remember one of the most memorable sermon moments for me happened at a general council in Portland, Oregon. I was a kid practically, and it was one of my first councils, and one of the speakers was David Yonggi Cho, pastor of the largest church in the world. And I remember one line from that sermon. He said, "Show me your vision and I'll show you your future." And it was such a powerful moment, and I think I knew that if God was going to use me, that I needed a vision from Him. And I think that began a journey for me of really trying to clarify what it was that the Lord had called me to. I would say right out of the gate that all of us have lots of different visions. You know, a vision for our life, for our families, for our ministries. And that's a good thing and a healthy thing. You know, an obvious question is, how do you get a vision? And that's beyond the scope of this particular video.
Anytime you cast vision, whether it's one-on-one, to a small group, or to your congregation, your vision casting needs to include these three components. And these are challenging. These are not easy to do. But if you will take the discipline, you know, have the discipline and take the time to work through these three things, you will become, even if you're not a platform person, you will become a compelling vision caster.
Bill, when I say vision, what are the first things that come to mind?
I think it's the most powerful weapon in a leader's arsenal.
Hmm.
I mean, certainly we need to build teams, solve problems, establish values. We need to do a lot of things, but you get to do those other things when you've already cast a vision that's put the whole organization in motion.
Vision casting is a completely unbiblical practice. First of all, nowhere is the concept mentioned in the Bible. Secondly, it implies that the pastor receives direct and new revelation from God. The assumption that the pastor's vision is divinely inspired carries with it prophetic implications. For example, in an infographic from Elevation Church called The Best Place to Work, it says, "We serve a lead pastor who seeks and hears from God. This conveys a top-down leadership hierarchy led by one man who claims to have a direct line to God. This is a recipe for all kinds of spiritual abuse and historically has led to disaster."
We are united under one vision. Elevation is built on the vision God gave Pastor Stephen. We will aggressively defend our unity and that vision.
Pastor Eric Dykstra of the Crossing Church allegedly received his vision from God.
We are united under the visionary. Now, the visionary here is Eric. The Crossing is built on the vision that God gave Pastor Eric.
Yeah.
And we will aggressively defend that vision. Now, what does that mean, you aggressively defend that? That means that we do church the way he wants us to do it. And me as a campus pastor, I can't go up to Zimmerman and decide that I'm going to preach on Sunday, because that's not the vision that we have for this church that God gave to Eric. Mm-hmm. And we defend that when people go, well, maybe we should do it this way. And we're like, no, you don't understand. God gave Eric this vision. We do it this way, because we don't want to argue with God, basically. We don't want to be like, you know, Eric's not God. We're not saying Eric's God. He's not God.
I'm not God.
But he's got a vision from God, and we have decided with our lives that we're going to follow that vision, mm-hmm. and we're going to stick to that. And if we ever just decide that we don't want to be a part of that vision, then we can go find a church and serve somewhere else. And that's okay. We're not telling anybody that they have to unite under this vision that Eric got from God. You can do whatever you want. But we think that it's a really cool vision. We're on board with it. And we're going to defend it, and we're going to stick to it.
So to argue with Eric is to argue with God. But these new revelations and visions contradict the doctrine of Jesus. Notice the church codes from both of these megachurches stated how the God-given vision of the pastor is to be aggressively defended.
And we will aggressively defend that vision.
We will aggressively defend our unity and that vision.
This means that the vision cannot be challenged. Any critique of the visionary is unacceptable, no matter how biblical that critique may be. To oppose the visionary is also to oppose God, because the vision supposedly came from God.
Well, let's talk about the other end of the continuum, those that are detractors, those that are fighting the vision. How do you deal with that side of the equation?
You know, test fly it, guinea pig it, do all that. And then when you have, when you're announcing a major new vision and you go through all these processes, then I love to say, now look, some of you are going to have a difficult time digesting all this. Mm-hmm. We're going to wait a week or so, and then we're going to have an open question and answer time down in our chapel. And we're going to listen to all of the concerns that you have about it.
Yeah.
Some of our best corrections have come by people who weren't really detractors. They were clarifiers. If you've done that three or four times and had all those Q&A times, and there are still some people mm-hmm. who are, at that point, actual stone throwers. I mean, they're just going to dig in and make your life miserable. I have a couple of extra, even one-on-one meetings with them, and then my big line, you've heard me use it before, I say, all right, you don't agree with this vision. I'm asking you as a fellow believer, don't sin in your disagreement with this vision. Don't sin. And so I have had the conversation with people saying, do you have to leave the church so you won't sin? Or could you stay in the church and not sin? And people go, I guess I could stay here. Am I?
Yeah.
Good.
I mean, that's such a cool picture, because I think a lot of leaders are tempted to think that binary in this regard.
Yeah.
They either will buy into the vision, hook, line, sinker, the whole deal,
yeah.
or I just need to have them leave the church.
Yeah. No,
when
no.
in fact, you know, maybe success is that they didn't sin and kept an open mind
yeah.
and stayed in community. Maybe that's success for certain people.
Yeah.
Reject. Do I need to spell that out? Why? That's so cold. It's so wise. How much heartache I could have saved our church over the last two decades if I had lowered my expectation of my ability to change the behavior of others and raised my expectation that people will be as they have been. A factious man is a danger to the church, and you are released by Scripture to release him. And I'm releasing you to take a small portion of your church's budget, build a catapult, put it in the church parking lot, and load it regularly. I think we can shoot this one right out of our county. All right?
Here's what I've learned. You cast vision for your mission,
And if people don't sign up, you move on. You move on. There are people that are going to die in the wilderness, and there are people that are going to take the hill. That's just how it is. Too many guys waste too much time trying to move stiff-necked, stubborn, obstinate people. I am all about blessed subtraction. There is a pile of dead bodies behind the Mars Hill bus. And by God's grace, it'll be a mountain by the time we're done. You either get on the bus or you get run over by the bus. Those are the options. But the bus ain't going to stop. And I'm just a guy who is like, look, we love you, but this is what we're doing. There's a few kind of people. There's people who get in the way of the bus, they got to get run over. There are people who want to take turns driving the bus, they got to get thrown off because they want to go somewhere else. There are people who will be on the bus, leaders and helpers and servants. They're awesome. There's also just sometimes nice people who sit on the bus and shut up. They're not helping or hurting. Just let them ride along.
Perry Noble says, a leader should never allow doubters to dictate the direction of their ministry. When God speaks, our obsession must be complete obedience. Peter the Apostle says, the elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that should be revealed, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock. Paul also said, not for that we have dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy, for by faith ye stand. The church growth model of leadership is unbiblical and worldly. Jesus himself said, you know that they which are accounted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But so shall it not be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister, and whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. Church leaders are to take their cue from Jesus as a servant. Often, these megachurches have membership covenants with clauses that contractually obligate you to leave if you disagree. These membership covenants can also be used as legal documents to protect the pastor and leadership. For example, a confidentiality agreement must be signed by employees and anyone who wishes to quote-unquote volunteer at Stephen Furtick's Elevation Church in Charlotte, North Carolina. This document legally binds the volunteer to a non-disclosure agreement of confidential information, such as the church's research, technical data, and financial information. The volunteer acknowledges that any breach of the covenant on their part will entitle the church to pursue any and all legal remedies against them. In an article called One Way to Increase the Commitment Level of Your Members, Warren says, when your congregation adopts a membership covenant, at least you're choosing the kind of people that stay. Warren then provides Saddleback's membership covenant as an example. This idea of a church membership covenant goes against the teaching of Christ on forbidding oaths. The type of people that are not welcome in these churches are those who would challenge the leadership with the Word of God or resist any kind of changes for church growth. Those who resist the changes necessary for monster growth must change or die. Rick Warren told pastors and church leaders, if your church has been plateaued for 6 months, it might take 6 months to get it going again. If it's been plateaued for a year, it might take a year. If it's been plateaued for 20 years, you've got to set in for the duration. I'm saying some people are going to have to die or leave. Moses had to wander around the desert for 40 years while God killed off 1 million people before he let them go into the promised land. That may be brutally blunt, but it's true. There may be people in your church who love God sincerely, but who will never, ever change. It is easy to see how these celebrity pastors have set up a system within the megachurch in which their vision cannot be challenged and they are unaccountable to the Word of God.
But elders that walk around with the capital A, heavy duty, I'm here to hold you accountable. Accountable, make you accountable, all right? That's a control move, all right? That's a control move, and it's rooted in pride, okay? And it's not the senior pastor's job. I'm sorry that you're not happy with your career, but it's not my job to make you feel significant by folding my full-time ministry under your 10-hour-a-week volunteer opportunity, okay?
Discernment ministries are labeled as extremist or haters.
Hey, haters, I hate to break this to you, but your day is done. See, we're done with the way you sling shame and blame in the face of anyone who doesn't say what you say and see what you see, read what you read, think what you think, and do what you do, how you do what you do. But it's not about you. We're sick and tired of your pervasive propensity to pick a fight and hide the light, nitpicking every single pixel of God's brilliant picture, seeing only your side in only black and white. So scared to death of difference, shaking your fist in the face of change. I hear you hating on some people because they're not deep enough, but it makes me wonder if depth is more a measure of love than it is about whether people sync up with every idiosyncratic opinion you've got. You're full of opinions, but you're low on the spirit, because the spirit is love. The spirit is peace. The spirit is kindness, and the only kind of words you ever seem to speak bring death to the hearer and leave weakness in their way. You look like a toddler, drawing lines in the sand, talking about how you're defending the truth and taking a stand. But for all your hating and pontificating and stances and games, there's no change. Fall back. It's a new day. Because we're not looking for approval from you who give no respect and never neglect the chance to complain. Are you going to criticize or create? Waste your time casting stones, breaking bones, belittling everyone you consider opposed? Are you going to exchange your hate, trade the pain of the same, embrace a new way to change the world? Honor's time has come, and a new light has dawned to still the tongue of the cynic and pierce the heart of the skeptic. This generation is waiting to restore the hope of a nation.
The standard rhetoric coming from these churches is that they teach the same message as traditional evangelicals, but only differ in methodology and philosophy of ministry. The methods change, but the message stays the same, is the cliche. For instance, Lee Strobel, former pastor at Willow Creek, now with Saddleback, writes, "Objections generally relate to the method that's used to communicate the gospel, not the message itself. And consequently, we're free to use our God-given creativity to present Christ's message in new ways that our target audience will connect with. But this is simply not the case. While the methodology may be disturbing, it is the message of the church growth movement that is of greater concern. The church growth movement is often found to be anti-doctrinal, not enduring sound doctrine and actually discouraging Bible study and sound doctrine. Both Rick Warren and C. Peter Wagner discourage the study of Bible prophecy."
He states that Bible prophecy is a diversion from the devil. You don't want to study Bible prophecy, even though a third of the Bible is prophecy.
Interpreting Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, Warren says, "When the disciples wanted to talk about prophecy, Jesus quickly switched the conversation to evangelism. He wanted them to concentrate on their mission in the world. He said, in essence, 'The details of my return are none of your business. What is your business is the mission I have given you. Focus on that. If you want Jesus to come back sooner, focus on fulfilling your mission, not figuring out prophecy.'" Wagner quotes Robert Schuller and says, Robert Schuller's advice to young church leaders would seem to apply to new apostolic Christians. Don't let eschatology stifle your long-term thinking. Rick Warren's movement emphasizes deeds, not creeds. He also tells us about his ideas of the judgment at the last day, saying, God won't ask about your religious background or doctrinal views. But the Apostle Paul told Titus that a bishop of a church must be able, by sound doctrine, both to exhort and convict those who contradict. 2 Timothy 4:3 says, For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers.
So once you buy into this particular leadership model, Rick Warren, who then, you know, brings along with him Perry Noble, Stephen Furtick, Mark Batterson, Ed Young Jr., Irwin McManus, and others, these become the guys that you look to. And all of them are vehemently anti-doctrinal.
There's always some yahoo in the crowd who climbs up in this chair. And they don't get it. They climb up in this chair and they go, feed me! Wait, pastor, feed me! Over here! They sit here whining, oh, I want more, deeper worship. I want more Bible study. Feed me!
You say, Perry, what about the jackass in the church? The jackass in the church is the person that always screams, I want to go deeper. You know what I tell people that say that around here? You're only as deep as the last person you served. You want to talk deep? Let's go check your tithing record and see how deep you are. Deep. Most Christians are, John Maxwell said it, most Christians are educated way beyond their level of obedience anyway. What you're really saying is you want me to stand on the stage and confuse the heck out of you so you don't have to apply what I teach on Sundays. I could do that.
I'm bound to make you mad. Did you show up to get mad this morning? Did you show up to file a little bit more religious information in your already overloaded hard drive so that you could do absolutely nothing about it? The church is full of pot-bellied Christians waiting to shove their spiritual food down their mouth one more time, but they don't intend to do anything to bless anybody. You are a Pharisee.
The Bible tells us that the law of Moses was made for anything that is contrary to sound doctrine, for the lawless, disobedient, ungodly, sinners, unholy, and profane. Thus, if the church growth movement is largely anti-doctrinal, the results are exceedingly sinful. When an internal survey of Willow Creek members revealed that large percentages of singles, 25% of singles, 38% of single parents, and 41% of divorced individuals, admitted having illicit sexual relations in the last 6 months, Hybels failed to focus on the seriousness of sin. Hybels did not call the congregation to repent for their rebellion against the holy God. Instead, he emphasized God's compassionate love. We are a love-starved people with broken hearts that need the kind of repair that only he can give long-term. During an exchange between Robert Schuller and Dr. Michael Horton on the White Horse Inn radio program, Schuller spoke on the doctrines of sin and justification. We are not justified by faith. No, it is by grace through faith. By grace through faith, that's right. But what I'm asking is this, justified from what? The wrath of God? Oh, I'll never use that language. But the Bible does. Yes, the Bible does. But the Bible is God's book to believers primarily. Listen, and then call me a heretic if you want. But I'm interested in attracting people and not driving them farther away. Even preaching the simple gospel message of Christ crucified and all its implications has often been silenced from these churches because it is unattractive. In a similar way, the Apostle Peter rebuked the Lord when Jesus told him that he would be crucified. The cross was an offense to Peter, but Jesus said, Get behind me, Satan, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake in the Gospels will save it.
Well, these churches were Baptist, Christian Missionary Alliance, Assemblies of God, Evangelical Free. They were all evangelical churches that were based originally on the idea of preaching the gospel. Okay? And then Rick Warren's program comes in, and he's telling them, no, you got to change this whole thing. People don't like pews. People don't like crosses. You got to go out and find out what the average person in your neighborhood wants to do if they were going to come to church at all. And you got to design a church that appeals to the unsaved out here. He drove the gospel out of more churches than anybody you can imagine. I did talk to Rick Warren, and he would deny that's what he did, but he did it. I've talked to hundreds and hundreds of people that since I started writing on this topic, and they all said the same thing. Once Rick Warren's program came in, the gospel went out. Hymns about the blood and about the cross, they went out. Some cases, even the piano went out. I don't know that he set out to destroy the entire evangelical movement, but he did a pretty good job of doing it.
The principles of self-esteem, felt needs, and personal fulfillment are also foundational to church growth. Robert Schuller wrote, "The new Reformation will return our focus to the sacred right of every person to self-esteem. The fact is, the church will never succeed until it satisfies the human being's hunger for self-value."
You feel better about yourself. Well, God's goal is not to make you feel better about yourself. I know this is going to sound terrible, but he isn't interested in self-esteem. He's interested in self-denial.
George Barna, the evangelical counterpart to George Gallup, says, "Ministry, in essence, has the same objective as marketing, to meet people's needs. Christian ministry, by definition, meets people's real needs by providing them with biblical solutions to their circumstances." Lee Strobel says, "The most effective messages for seekers are those that address their felt needs." Rick Warren also says, "It is my deep conviction that anybody can be won to Christ if you discover the key to his or her heart. It may take some time to identify it, but the most likely place to start is with the person's felt needs. While most unbelievers aren't looking for truth, they are looking for relief." This concept of felt needs is related to marketing research, being relevant, and satisfying the customer. If we can convince people that Christ died to meet their felt needs, they will buy our product. But can the church borrow the marketing tools of the world and apply them to the church? Unlike cheeseburgers or coffee, which may have great attraction to consumers, the gospel is foolish to the unsaved. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For since, in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. Notice how Jesus dealt with felt needs. At Capernaum, Jesus exposed the motives of the multitudes who followed him when he said, "You seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled." Miracles in the New Testament point to the person and work of Christ, yet the multitudes sought Jesus because of their felt need of hunger, which according to Jesus was the wrong reason. He said, "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life." Rather than meeting their felt needs, Jesus told them to believe on him, and they murmured. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Bill Hybels decided that the felt need that deserved most attention was personal fulfillment. While Schuller redefines sin in relation to self-esteem, Hybels adds a pragmatic twist to the definition of sin as a flawed strategy to gain fulfillment. But Jesus does not guarantee fulfillment as a result of following him. In fact, the direct opposite is communicated when Jesus says, "If you were of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Church growth, purpose-driven and seeker-driven pastors are seeking to please men by giving them fulfillment, self-esteem, and meeting their felt needs. The Bible warns against this. For our exhortation did not come from error or uncleanness, nor was it in deceit. But as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God, who tests our hearts. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I still pleased men, I would not be the bondservant of Christ. G.A. Pritchard also observes the psychological influence on Bill Hybels' Willow Creek Community Church. The psychological categories Hybels teaches, however, become fundamental categories for how Willow Creek Christians view themselves, their relationships, and life in general. Ironically, while Hybels is evangelizing those in the world toward Christianity, he is also evangelizing Christians toward the world. As the unchurched Harry in the audience, 10%, move closer to Christianity, the Christians in the audience, 90%, are often becoming more psychological and worldly. In Ladies' Home Journal, a secular magazine, Rick Warren wrote an article entitled Learn to Love Yourself in March 2005. He told readers, "To truly love yourself, you need to know the five truths that form the basis of a healthy self-image, which included accept yourself, love yourself, be true to yourself, forgive yourself, and believe in yourself." These are all pop psychology phrases and completely miss the mark of Jesus' teachings. While we are told to love others as we love ourselves, the scriptures also inform us that we already love ourselves in Ephesians 5, 28-29. We do not need to be encouraged in self-love that amounts to self-centeredness. In fact, the Bible declares self-love to be a sinful indication of the last days. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves. A primary felt need of unbelievers is entertainment. These churches are designed much like theaters, complete with stadium seating, lighting and sound technicians, dance and drama performances in the sanctuary.
Merry Christmas, you filthy animal.
Author G.A. Pritchard describes how Willow Creek is merely a continuation of the 1974 youth group Sun City. Former associate pastor Don Cousins explained that in many ways Willow Creek was an adult Sun City. Yet Sun City seemed to stretch the boundaries of youth ministry, writes Pritchard. Utilizing entertainment to appeal to unbelievers, the sanctuary was once decorated as a jail. Full-scale gymnastics were once used. They held the Hallowed Queen competition, where teenage boys came dressed in drag. Sun City's leaders explain, "We are in the auditorium and the windows are open and the music is howling at ear-splitting decibels. There are flashing lights going all over the place with these big ambulance lights. There are kids literally bouncing off the walls, screaming at the top of their lungs. Everything that you would not think would be happening in a church sanctuary is definitely happening in a church sanctuary."
display of power because we have professional motocross racer Steve Dennis right here, right now. And Steve, show us what it's all about. Give him a welcome, guys. Think he can jump this? Cheer for him and see if he can do it. Come on now, get him going, get him going. Get him going. Woo, yeah.
So I'm praying one morning. I'm like, God, how are we going to start this thing out? I'm in my basement. I got my iPod. I'm lifting weights. The song by AC/DC, Highway to Hell, comes on. I said, that'll do it. Now, I know you shouldn't listen to AC/DC when you're working out, but I do, and it's awesome.
We know that entertainment is a product of the world's substitute for true joy, and has no place in the house of God. This movement is allowing the world to define the church, rather than letting the Word of God define it. The Apostle Peter says, "In regard to these, they, unbelievers, think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation, speaking evil of you." Peter said that we spent enough of our past lifetime in abominable idolatries of worldly entertainment, and that we should no longer live the rest of our lifetime in the flesh. Nevertheless, entertainment is being brought into the church to appeal to unbelievers.
Thing though, James, that's the other thing. We really do have a heart. When we get together, we don't just get together and go, how can we piss a lot of people off? I know, Highway to Hell, that'll do it. I mean, we pray, we seek the Lord, we're asking, we're begging for His direction. It's not just me going, I think I got a good shock effect thing this Easter. It's we really come together with a purpose of what do we really feel that God wants us to do in the service.
Celebrity pastor Mark Driscoll of Mars Hill Church in Seattle explained his technique for achieving church growth by responding to the sexual lusts of the young students and singles within his congregation. I assumed the students and singles were all pretty horny, so I went out on a limb and preached through the Song of Songs in the fall. Each week I extolled the virtues of marriage, foreplay, oral sex, sacred stripping, and sex outdoors, just as the book teaches, because all scripture is indeed profitable. Driscoll also answered sexually explicit questions within the church.
Is masturbation a legitimate form of birth control? See, I don't know what's coming, so I can't prepare for this. Now, on the subject of masturbation, I will say this. The Bible doesn't say anything. Masturbation is not a sin. Look how quiet it got. Can I do it?
But Jesus never went into this sexually explicit detail. The Lord simply said, "But I say to you, whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. For it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish and for your whole body to be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. For it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell." Driscoll also claims to have the gift of discernment, which allows him to see the sexual sins of his congregation.
On occasion, I see things. Like I was meeting with one person, and they didn't know this, but they were abused when they were a child. And I said, "When you were a child, you were abused. This person did this to you, physically touched you this way." He said, "How do you know?" I said, "I don't know. It's like I got a TV right here, and I'm seeing it." I said, "No, that never happened." I said, "Go ask them. Go ask them if they actually did what I think they did, and I see that they did." And they went and asked this person, "When I was a little kid, did you do this?" And the person said, "Yeah, but you were only like a year or two old. How do you remember that?" I said, "Oh, Pastor Mark told me." Okay, I'm not a guru. I'm not a freak. I don't talk about this. If I did talk about it, everybody would want to meet with me, and I'd end up like one of those guys on TV. But some of you have this visual ability to see things. There was one woman I dealt with. She'd never told her husband that she had committed adultery on him early in the relationship. I said, you know, she's sitting there with her husband. I said, you know, I think the root of all this, I think Satan has a foothold in your life because you've never told your husband about that really tall blonde guy that you met at the bar. And then you went back to the hotel. She's just looking at me like, I said, you know, it was about 10 years ago. See everything. She says, she looks at her husband. He says, is that true? She says, yeah. He was 6'2", blonde hair, blue eyes. Yeah. Some of you, when you're counseling, you will see things. I mean, you will literally, gift of discernment, see things. I can't even explain it. It doesn't happen all the time. Sometimes your counselee, they will see things. I found this with people. I said, okay, now I'm going to ask the demon questions. You tell me what they say. They don't say anything. It's like, what are you hearing? They said, nothing. They said, but I'm seeing stuff. I'm like, well, tell me, what's that? I'm seeing, you know, when I was little, my grandpa molested me. I didn't know that. I said, well, let's not assume it's true. Go ask your grandpa. Grandpa says, yeah, when you were little, I molested you. Grandpa was assuming they'd be too young to remember. So he'd only molest grandkids up until a certain age. But they saw it. It's a supernatural. It's the whole other realm. It's like the Matrix. You can take the blue pill, you can take the red pill. You go into this whole other world. And that's the way it works. So I say, tell me everything you hear, tell me everything you see, and sometimes I see things too. I see things too. I've seen women raped. I've seen children molested. I've seen people abused. I've seen people beaten. I've seen horrible things done. Horrible things done. I've seen children dedicated in occultic groups, and demons come upon them as an infant by invitation. And I wasn't present for any of it, but I've seen it visibly. Upon occasion, when I get up to preach, I'll see, just like a screen in front of me, I'll see somebody get raped or abused, and then I'll track them down and say, look, I had this vision, let me tell you about it. All true. One I had, I was sitting in my office at the old Earl building. This gal walks by, nice gal, member of the church. It's when the church was small. And it was just like a TV was there, and I saw the night before, her husband threw her up against the wall, had her by the throat, was physically violent with her, and she said, that's it, I'm telling the pastors. And he said, if you do, I'll kill you. He was a very physically abusive man. She was walking by, and I just saw it. It's like a TV. I said, hey, come here for a sec. I said, last night, did your husband throw you up against the wall and have you by the throat, physically assault you, and tell you if you told anyone that he would kill you? And she just starts bawling. She says, how did you know? I said, Jesus told me. Call the guy on the phone. Hey, I need you to come to the office. Didn't give him any clue. Comes in. I said, dude, what'd you do to your wife last night? Why'd you do this? Why'd you throw her against the wall? And he gets very angry. They're sitting on the couch. He says, why did you tell him? I said, she didn't. Jesus did. Jesus did. And there are some people that have real gift of discernment, and I'm not saying I'm 100% always right with it, but some of you are going to have gift of discernment, and you need to learn to grow in the use of that gift. And sometimes people will hear things, sometimes people will see things.
In Mark Driscoll's book, Real Marriage, he advocates many unbiblical sexual practices for married couples. Driscoll is obviously an extreme in his sexual licentious preaching, but it nonetheless exemplifies the church growth principles of meeting felt needs. Depending on the felt needs of a congregation, in this case of Mars Hill being predominantly youthful and lustful, church growth practices end in worldliness. John the Apostle said, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." In seeking to please the world, these megachurches often mirror the world, even its debauched practices. For instance, the Harlem Shake was an internet craze in the form of a video which went viral in early 2013. Many people from all over the world uploaded their own similar performances of people dancing lasciviously in costumes, accompanied with a short excerpt from the song Harlem Shake. Then, many churches, such as Saddleback's High School Ministry, uploaded their own Harlem Shake videos.
Con los terroristas.
Rick Warren describes how the purpose-driven or market-driven paradigm is a franchise system which any pastor can transfer to his church in order to replicate the same church growth results produced at Warren's Saddleback Church model. He says, "Well, one of our values is what I call the good enough principle. A person doesn't have to be perfect for God to use them. Because we want our church to be a model for other churches, we want average people doing average activities in order to get extraordinary results. Just like how the typical McDonald's is able to succeed while being staffed by high school students. Because the system works, it doesn't require unusual talent. Thus, church growth principles may be practiced in any congregation to produce the same growing results of success. In fact, the conclusion of the church growth movement is that preaching should be judged by numerical results." McGavran says, "In view of all this and much more evidence, must we not consider mission and intention a vast and purposeful finding? Is it possible biblically to maintain that only search is the thing? Motives are what matter. And the finding of multitudes of persons is something rather shabbily mechanical and success-ridden. Can we believe it theologically tenable to be uninterested in the numbers of the redeemed?" Elevation Church unapologetically confesses that they are all about the numbers. Part of the Elevation Code says, "We are all about the numbers. Tracking metrics measures effectiveness. We unapologetically set goals and measure progress through all available quantitative means."
I have seen 426 people baptized over a span of 3 weeks in our church this past May. No. That wasn't a sufficient woo! Because you have to understand that our church had less than 20 people less than 2 years ago. This morning we'll meet in two campus locations, Providence High School and Porter Ridge High School in Union County. We'll have well over 2,500 people that will attend our worship experiences. Since February, we've seen 600 people give their lives to Jesus Christ. That includes 18 that gave their lives to Jesus this past Sunday. At our high school service called Pulse. And if you're new here, you're going, "Why are they clapping about the numbers? Is it all about the numbers?" Excuse me. Yes! Yes, it's all about the numbers. Yes, it's all about the numbers.
Consider how it was Satan who provoked David to number Israel, and the anger of the Lord kindled against Israel that moved David to number Israel. Certainly then God is disposed with the numbering of his church, or basing the success of preaching upon numbers rather than faithfulness to the gospel. The Lord wants our trust to be in him alone and not in numbers. It is God who gives church growth, not according to the craftiness and wisdom of men, but according to his Holy Spirit. The Apostle Paul said, "I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase." So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. It is the Lord alone that adds to the church such as should be saved. It is the conclusion of the church growth movement that God's will for every local congregation is numerical growth. In fact, Warren states, "Forget church growth. Church health is the key to church growth. All living things grow if they're healthy. You don't have to make them grow, it's just natural for living organisms." But according to these church growth standards of numerical success and growth, many prophets of the scriptures would be considered the greatest failures of all time. Noah, for instance, preached for 100 years and no one believed him. In the book of Revelation, Jesus never mentions church growth in his rebukes or his commendations of local churches. The two churches that were commended with no rebuke from the Lord Jesus were Smyrna and Philadelphia. Both of these churches were small, poor, lacking in influence, but were faithful to God. The church growth movement assumes that all numerical growth is good growth. Why should we assume that all growth is good growth? Quantitative or numerical growth is not the same as qualitative growth. In the end, Numerical growth justifies the various methods of church growth pragmatism. C. Peter Wagner agrees. We ought to see clearly that the end does justify the means. What else possible could justify the means? If the method I am using accomplishes the goal I am aiming at, it is for that reason a good method. The seeker-driven and purpose-driven churches are adding secular philosophy and pragmatism to the gospel, much like the Colossians to whom Paul wrote, "Beware, lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the traditions of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ." If pragmatism is our guide, the church will be tossed about by every wind of doctrine. Willow Creek released its findings of a multiple-year qualitative study of its ministry. With so many programs and activities in the church, Heibel said the results were earth-shaking and mind-blowing.
But that survey just rocked my world. It was one of the hardest things I've ever had to digest as a leader, because some of the stuff that we have put millions of dollars in, thinking it would really help our people grow and develop spiritually, when the data actually came back, it wasn't helping people that much. Other things that we didn't put much money into and didn't put much staff against is stuff that our people are crying out for.
Heibel's multi-million-dollar organization, which has great influence on other church leaders, has proven unprofitable in regard to spiritual growth. Heibel's confessed.
So Greg Hawkins, again, just brilliant guy. He goes, "Bill, we've made a mistake. What we should have done at about this point, when people cross the line of faith, become Christians, we should have started telling people and teaching people that they have to take responsibility to become self-feeders. We should have gotten people, taught them how to read their Bible between services, how to do the spiritual practices much more aggressively on their own."
The church growth principles utilize the wisdom of the world for its foundation rather than Christ. Paul specifically warned of the dangers of building the church upon foundations other than Jesus. "For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet as through fire. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, 'He catches the wise in their own craftiness,' and again, 'The Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile.'" In contrast to the attractiveness and craftiness of church growth leaders, it was said of Paul that his bodily presence is weak and his speech contemptible, while Rick Warren says, "We slander God's character if we preach with an uninspiring style or tone." The Apostle Paul said, "My speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power." The Apostle Paul's message was never determined by the felt needs of his audience. His message was always Christ crucified. "But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified." Paul refused to let anything compromise his simple gospel message.
I think this seeker-sensitive approach to ministry, because it's so obsessed with the idea of making Christ seem appealing or cool, or making the gospel seem as easily embraceable as possible, often all of the aspects of gospel truth that might be a stumbling block to someone have been deliberately removed. Everything's deliberately taken out so that there isn't anything about sin and repentance or the justice of God and the wrath of God against sin. And the effect of that then is to draw people to respond and to unite with the visible church who really have never been converted. They've never really confronted the reality of their guilt. They've never really trusted Christ for salvation from sin. They think they're following Christ because they're following the Christ that's been portrayed by these pragmatic ministers. And so they unite with the church, and the effect of it has been to fill the church with false converts, people who think they're Christians, who probably believe they are Christians, but they've never truly been converted. They've never left behind anything that they loved before. They've never really laid hold of the Christ of Scripture and loved him. And so they don't really believe him. And they're unbelievers who think they're believers, who call themselves Christians. And the church is filled today with people like that. And so it's a mixed multitude.
The celebrity pastors of the church growth movement give new meaning to turning the house of God into a marketplace. In John chapter 2, verses 14 through 16, Jesus found in the temple those who sold oxen and sheep and doves and the money changers doing business. When he had made a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overturned the tables. And he said to those who sold doves, "Take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise." Notice how Stephen Furtick's pulpit is surrounded with ads for his book, Crash the Chatterbox. Pastors like Furtick have used their non-profit pulpits to make a profit from books. Likewise, Mark Driscoll preaches with the logo of his book Real Marriage in the background. Celebrity pastors such as Furtick, Noble, and Driscoll have used tax-free money from their congregations to pay marketing firms to get their books on the bestseller lists. For instance, a company called Result Source Incorporated requires authors to make bulk purchases of their own books, then breaks those orders up into small increments to make them look like organic retail sales. World Magazine reported how Driscoll's Mars Hill Church paid at least $210,000 in 2011 and 2012 to ensure that his book, Real Marriage, made the New York Times bestseller list. Not only is this dishonest, it is an unethical use of God's resources in the church. But, as a result, these celebrity pastors can call themselves best-selling authors for the rest of their careers. Though we don't read of Jesus being violent or hurting anyone, his actions were forceful against the merchandisers who set up shop in the place of worship. He said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you have made it a den of thieves." Like the postmodern emergent church movement, the purpose-driven and seeker-sensitive organizations have generally promoted the spiritual disciplines of contemplative mysticism. One reason why these innovative market-driven pastors are promoting mysticism is because the world is looking for new ways to experience God.
It's not just a matter of coming and sitting in a pew and enduring 50 or 70 or whatever minutes of observing something happen, but it's saying, "I want to experience God. I'm interested in coming into an experience here."
One Leadership Network study revealed that the fastest growing segment of the publishing industry were books on religion and spirituality, an outstanding trend is Jewish mysticism and Kabbalah. Another Leadership Network study says, "Why is mysticism re-emerging today? The emerging culture is less dependent upon a scientific and rationalistic way of thinking and has moved to a time when people want to experience God." On page 221 of The Purpose-Driven Life, Rick Warren promotes spiritual disciplines. He says, "These character-building habits are often called spiritual disciplines, and there are dozens of great books that can teach you how to do these." On page 126 of The Purpose-Driven Church, Warren lists five major parachurch movements which seem to focus on a single purpose that he believes is valid and even helpful to the church. Among these, he listed what he called the Discipleship Spiritual Formations Movement. Among the authors included in this movement, he listed Richard Foster and Dallas Willard, who underscored the importance of building up Christians and establishing personal spiritual disciplines. This spiritual formation movement promotes contemplative prayer through the spiritual disciplines. In the Christianity Today article called The Emergent Mystique, emergent church leader Brian McLaren also named Richard Foster as one of the key mentors for the emerging church.
Richard Foster and Dallas Willard, these guys are basically modern purveyors, and John Ortberg has picked up on all of this too. They're modern purveyors in what is centuries-old Roman Catholic mysticism. And so the idea is that you can have a direct experience with God if you do such and such disciplines.
Rick Warren actually aligns himself and promotes the contemplative prayer movement.
In the book Rick Warren and the Purpose That Drives Him, the author responds, "Nowhere in Warren's book does he endorse, refer to, positively mention, or dabble in contemplative prayer. However, we find irrefutable evidence of Warren promoting contemplative practices and endorsing other contemplative prayer teachers. In issue number 56 of Rick Warren's Ministry Toolbox, he recommends Celebration of Discipline by Richard Foster. The newsletter states, "Foster was a disciple of Dallas Willard. This book is an excellent primer of the spiritual disciplines that lead to a deeper life with God." In Richard Foster's own words out of the same book recommended by Warren, he says, "We should all, without shame, enroll as apprentices in the school of contemplative prayer."
Christian contemplative prayer is kind of a misleading term because people that are unfamiliar with it would think that it had something to do with contemplating in the old sense of the word, where you kind of think deeply on something. In essence, Christian contemplative prayer is about not thinking. It's employing a word or phrase which is repeated over and over again for about 20 minutes. And you might ask, well, where did this come from? Well, it came from a group of mystics known as the Desert Fathers, who lived in North Africa and the Middle East in the early Middle Ages. And according to reliable sources, it says it was a time of great experimentation with spiritual methods. Many different kinds of disciplines were tried. Many different methods of prayer were created and explored by them. So this idea of using a word or phrase chanted or repeated over and over again did not come from the Bible. It came from experimentation and development from these desert mystics.
Brennan Manning was also quoted in Rick Warren's Ministry Toolbox. Manning is most well known for his book The Ragamuffin Gospel, which was once one of 10 must-read books on the Saddleback Family website.
One of the major proponents of mysticism in the church currently, a man by the name of Brennan Manning, and he wrote a book called The Signature of Jesus, and he says if you do this kind of prayer, you'll have the signature of Jesus on your prayer life. So he says the first step in faith is to stop thinking about God at the time of prayer. Well, how can someone stop thinking about God? I mean, how is that the first step in faith? Well, the thing is, that is what mysticism is all about. You have to switch off your mind. You know, it's not intellectual. It's you're putting yourself in an altered state of consciousness. Then he says contemplative spirituality tends to emphasize the need for a change in consciousness. In other words, your awareness is totally switched into another realm. We must come to see reality differently. And how is this done? The following: choose a single sacred word, repeat the sacred word inwardly, slowly, and often. This is usually done for about 20 minutes. So you're just constantly saying this word or phrase over and over again for 20 minutes. Then he says, enter into the great silence of God. Alone in that silence will the noise within subside and the voice of love will be heard. So he's saying to really hear the word of God, you know, actual, not the Bible, not the word of God as far as the Bible goes, but to actually hear the word of God audibly, you have to go into this great silence of God to understand it. And that's what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with so-called Christian mysticism because these words and phrases are Christian in nature.
Rick Warren also teaches this contemplative spiritual discipline in his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, saying, "The Bible tells us to pray all the time. How is it possible to do this? One way is to use breath prayers throughout the day, as many Christians have done for centuries. You choose a brief sentence or a simple phrase that can be repeated to Jesus in one breath. With practice, you can develop the habit of praying silent breath prayers. Jesus taught specifically against this spiritual practice, or discipline, of repeating words or phrases central to contemplative prayer. He said, "And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him." The commands to pray without ceasing and to pray always are not literal as the mystics affirm, because Jesus himself ceased from prayer. And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased. Rather, these commands teach us to continually petition God as the persistent widow, a parable Jesus taught so that men ought always to pray and not to faint, not literally every moment of every day, but to never give up on asking God. Secondly, when asked how to pray, Jesus answered, "When you pray, say, 'Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.' When you pray, say." Therefore, sitting in silence or making breath prayers would be a direct contradiction of how Jesus taught us to pray.
Yeah, I fear because of Rick Warren's efforts to promote contemplative prayer and mystical practice that Karl Rahner's prediction, prophetic view of the future is coming true, that the Christian of the future will be a mystic, or they will not be a Christian at all.
Because of these contemplative practices endorsed by Warren, many have connected him to the emergent church.
I believe that Rick Warren was touting and promoting the emerging church even before it had that name.
Since Rick Warren's popularity has exploded, and he did have an early alignment with the emergent movement, that's created actually some problems for him, and he's tried to back off from it.
Rick Warren has criticized the emerging church and its preoccupation with postmodernism. Yet, Warren's ministry toolbox on his website, pastors.com, has featured several articles favorably presenting the emergent church movement and its leaders, such as Brian McLaren, Doug Padgett, Tony Jones, and Dan Kimball. In Rick Warren's July 6, 2005 e-newsletter, he featured an article he wrote entitled, "Sharing Eternal Truth with an Ever-Emerging Culture." One of the recommended links in this issue was to emergent leader Spencer Burke's organization, The Ooze. Spencer Burke's The Ooze is described as a community that learns from faith traditions outside the Christian fold, with a Buddhist family in their church, with whom they visited a Buddhist temple and participated in guided meditation with this family.
There's power in listening to the heretic. And today, I actually think that we need to listen to a few heretics in our world.
When you go to pastors.com, his website, there's an endorsement of emergent books. There's an endorsement of emergent practices. In fact, Dan Kimball's book, called The Emergent Church. He actually endorsed Dan Kimball's book on the emerging church. In fact, he wrote the sidebars alternating with Brian McLaren for that book. In fact, I'll quote to you what he says about that book, which I think it makes it quite clear where he stands with much of the emerging church right here. Warren states, quote, "This book is a wonderful, detailed example of what a purpose-driven church can look like in a postmodern world. My friend Dan Kimball writes passionately, while my book, The Purpose-Driven Church, explained what the church is called to do, Dan's book explains how to do it with the cultural creatives who think and feel in postmodern terms. You need to pay attention to him because times are a-changing," end quote.
I almost have to laugh when people say, Rick Warren's passé, but the emerging church, that's what's happening now, when they don't even realize that he's one of the main taproots of emerging church, without him actually having the label.
Considering how much these movements have in common, it is no surprise that emergent church leader Brian McLaren attributes his becoming a pastor to Rick Warren. He writes, "I literally would not be doing what I am doing if not for Rick's impact on my life." Why would a supposedly conservative evangelical pastor like Rick Warren want to lend his credibility to the emergent church and have his name be directly associated with its leaders? The answer may be found in Warren's mentor, Peter Drucker, and Leadership Network, the organization that initiated the Emergent Church.
I've had 9 different mentors in my life. Some of them were famous, some of them were not famous at all. But one of them was Peter Drucker, the founder of Modern American Management. He wrote dozens and dozens of books, and I knew him up to his death in his mid-90s. And for 20 years, he was a mentor, and I would drive up to his house, and I would go in, and as a young pastor, I'd want to tell him all the things that I was doing. Today, I'm standing outside of the House of Industry, where I'm going to go in and be the keynote speaker for the 100th centennial of Peter Drucker.
On November 19th, 2009, leaders from the business and public sector, scholars, teachers, economists, and representatives of the nonprofit sector from all over the world gathered in Vienna, Austria, to commemorate the 100th birthday of Peter F. Drucker.
Peter was far more than the founder of modern management. He was far more than a brilliant man, one of the greatest minds of the 20th century. He was a great soul.
For nearly 25 years, Peter was a mentor to me and had a profound influence on my life in the particular area of leadership and personal development.
Peter Drucker was born in 1909 in Austria and immigrated to America in 1937. He was a writer, management consultant, and self-described social ecologist. Drucker had taught at California's Claremont Graduate School for more than 30 years, where the Management Center carries on his name. He published over 30 books in addition to articles for the Wall Street Journal, Harvard Business Review, and Forbes. His books and popular scholarly articles explored how people are organized across the business, government, and the nonprofit sectors of society. Before his death in 2005, he had a worldwide reputation as the father of modern management.
In the 1950s, he invents the modern corporation. Drucker's vision was that somebody who was part of a corporation, the corporation that he structured, they would feel part of something bigger than themselves. They would be part of a community, and that they would be able to experience success along with the successes of the company, and they knew their part in helping to bring about what, you know, the vision that the CEO had for the corporation. And since the 1950s until now, the majority of corporations now work off of the Druckerite model.
Drucker was committed to the existential philosophy of Danish writer Soren Kierkegaard.
Kierkegaard had his influence from Kant, and the idea that we live and there's an upper and lower story, that you have the lower story, which has to do with those things that can be proved scientifically, even though this is now disputed, of course, that there is the ability of science to come up with absolutes. This seemed to be the answer, that there are no absolutes, and this is what you get from Kierkegaard.
Peter Drucker is a Soren Kierkegaardian existentialist. He spends his adult life really trying to solve that existential alienation problem that is caused by the displacement of modern technologies.
Concerning religious philosophies, Peter Drucker was influenced by Zen, Japanese artwork, and Confucianism. Earlier in his life, he drew upon the wisdom of the philosopher Martin Buber. Among Buber's published works are I and Thou, which teaches a form of existentialism, and Ecstatic Confessions, the heart of mysticism. Expressing his own religious philosophy and the pantheistic influence of Buber, Drucker writes, "Society needs a return to spiritual values, not to offset the material, but to make it fully productive. Mankind needs to return to spiritual values, for it needs compassion. It needs the deep experience that the Thou and the I are one, which all higher religions share." This presentation would not permit the time to unpack the philosophies of Zen, Confucianism, German mysticism, and existentialism. Drucker's own confession should suffice to demonstrate that he was not a Christian.
I'm not the born-again Christian, no. I've been going to church, and I've been tithing all my life, but I do not claim to be And the best thing I wrote was an essay on a great religious thinker. I said, if you read one thing of mine, read my essay on Kierkegaard. The best, what?
I have.
The best thing I ever wrote, easily.
Drucker's view of the nature of man is not derived from the Bible, but rather from the ever-changing social sciences. He created a new postmodern, non-economic man, which is incomplete without community. Drucker's first book, The End of Economic Man, was written in 1939 after fleeing from fascist totalitarianism of the Nazi regime. Drucker wrote, "The Western democracies have to realize that totalitarian fascism cannot be overcome by socialism, by capitalist democracy, or by a combination of both. It can only be overcome by a new, non-economic concept of a free and equal society." This new society became Drucker's project for the rest of his life. In the first half of the 20th century, Drucker saw the corporation as the organism that could meet man's felt need for community. But the corporation failed to fulfill Drucker's vision. Beginning in the mid-60s, Drucker discovered that the megachurch would be the entity to provide humanity with a healthy and socialized community. But this discovery had nothing to do with Christianity. In fact, Drucker criticized Christianity as being too individualistic. In spite of his need and search, Christianity and the churches have been unable to provide a religious social solution. All they can do today is to give the individual religion. They cannot give a new society and a new community. Personal religious experience may be invaluable to the individual. It may restore his peace, may give him a personal God and rational understanding of his own function and nature, but it cannot recreate society and cannot make social community life sensible. Therefore, Drucker was intrigued by megachurches, not because of their spiritual beliefs, but because they pragmatically met felt needs of humanity.
Drucker decided that the megachurch seemed to be the best approach to appeal to the American culture. The megachurch had greater influence on the culture in the United States than did academia, the university system, educational system, the corporate world of America. In fact, they were the ones that got things done.
How did you get interested in the megachurch?
Because I looked out the window. There was that phenomenon, period. And I'm curious.
But not from a religious...
What?
I mean, you were not interested from a personal religious point of view? Or?
No. My interest in the megachurches was as a social phenomenon, as the but we talked about it yesterday, my old and abiding interest in community. I saw them creating community.
To Drucker, his interest in the megachurch was purely from a sociological and economical standpoint. Denominations and sound doctrine was not a consideration for Drucker.
There's a Forbes article that was written maybe about 2001, 2002, where they were asking why he switched gears from the business world to the religious world. He said, if theologians were left in charge of animal biology, they would tell us that there's only one right finch in the world. But there's 243 different species or varieties of finch, and they're all right. And then theologians will have us arguing about theology and doctrine and stuff like that. That doesn't matter. All of them are right.
It was specifically Drucker's quest for optimum community which led him to the megachurch as the most effective agent of change in American life.
Early years were spent on politics. The middle portion of his career was spent in the corporate world. The last part of his career was spent in religion, in Christianity as a whole. He took three disciples. Rick Warren, Bill Hybels, and Bob Buford of Leadership Network.
Christianity Today reported, "Over the last 20 years, Drucker has had a good deal of interaction with what he calls pastoral churches. These include megachurches like Bill Hybels' Willow Creek or Rick Warren's Saddleback Community. Bob Buford's Leadership Network has invited Drucker to speak to conferences of large church leaders and has linked him to many pastors seeking advice. Because of Drucker's influence, many are reluctant to dismiss the incredible success of these organizations as mere coincidence.
That those two would become the two, probably the two most influential two pastors in the entire country, let alone the Western world. Now, was that just coincidence?
The Peter Drucker-Rick Warren relationship may surprise many, but it dates back over two decades to when the young Rick Warren came to Drucker for advice. Under Drucker's tutelage, Warren's own success has been considerable as his Saddleback Church has grown to be one of the largest churches in America, and his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, is this decade's bestseller.
He took the concepts from Drucker and created a system where he could reproduce his Saddleback to current churches. And so he exported this whole thing.
Rick Warren stated, "I did a series of lectures for the faculty in the Kennedy School and also in the law school. I spoke to several groups of faculty and several groups of students, and I started with this quote from Peter Drucker, 'The most significant sociological phenomenon of the first half of the 20th century was the rise of the corporation. The most significant sociological phenomenon of the second half of the 20th century has been the development of the large pastoral church, of the megachurch. It is the only organization that is actually working in our society.'" Now, Drucker has said that at least six times. I happen to know because he's my mentor. I've spent 20 years under his tutelage learning about leadership from him, and he's written it in two or three books, and he says he thinks it's the only thing that really works in society.
What do you say to a group of Druckerites about Peter Drucker? I mean, I could easily stand here and rattle off 100 Drucker principles and proverbs that you all know. And we all know them because they're all so memorable. But I don't want to talk to you, as we just close tonight, in just a word, not about his principle, but about Peter the man. I loved Peter Drucker. I didn't just admire him. I love this man. In my life, I've had a number of different mentors in different areas of my life. And Peter was one of those mentors.
Stephen Lee, pastor of the Purpose-Driven Hong Kong campus, first met Rick Warren in 2006, quote, "because he has heard so much about him during his time working as the CEO of Peter Drucker Academy, the first private company registered in China as a charity organization," unquote. It is this shared love for Drucker that brought the two together. Saddleback Church reported in Bringing Saddleback to Hong Kong, "Saddleback Hong Kong is a strategic church because of the connections it has with China. Stephen's years at Peter Drucker taught him many of the same principles and values that Saddleback Church has." Stephen inserts, "Ordinary people make a difference. Ordinary people do extraordinary things. It comes from Peter Drucker." I am able to agree to this in such short time with only a month of training because I know Peter Drucker in depth. Saddleback Church and Rick Warren stand for the same. Notice that Stephen Lee acknowledges that Saddleback Church and Rick Warren stand for the same thing as Peter Drucker. Lee can say this with such confidence because he knows Peter Drucker in depth. He said it is by Peter Drucker that ordinary people do extraordinary things. The source is admittedly Drucker, not Jesus Christ.
Peter Drucker was a truly Renaissance man. He studied widely, he read widely, and he understood society as a whole probably better than anybody of his generation. Certainly was brilliant, but he is often known simply in the area of management and economics, but really he had much more to offer than that. He was a keen observer of society and the impact of demography on society, the impact of social trends on society, the impact of spirituality and religion, and his general consensus attitude was, it all matters.
Within the pages of The Essential Drucker by Peter Drucker, we read about how Bill Hybels also utilized Drucker's business practices to design a church that catered to the customer's needs. It says, Willow Creek Community Church in South Barrington, Illinois, outside Chicago, has become the nation's largest church. Bill Hybels designed a church to answer the potential customer's needs. G.A. Pritchard wrote, Willow Creek's strategy has also been discussed in the pages of Fortune magazine and the Wall Street Journal. In the latter, Peter Drucker explains that Willow Creek and its imitators are employing simple marketing ideas. None of these marketing lessons are new. Anyone who has taken a marketing course these past 30 years or who has read a marketing text should know them. In Bill Hybels' book, Courageous Leadership, he cites his conversations with Drucker in regard to leadership. In his own words, under a subsection entitled Consulting Mentors About Performance Evaluations, Hybels referred to Peter Drucker as one of the two men who have most shaped my thinking on this issue, next to Jesus. Hybels crystallized his vision for Willow Creek in the 1980s at a dinner conversation with Drucker. Before Leadership Network, aka the Emerging Church, began, its founder, Bob Buford, was also consulting with Drucker. Bob Buford is not only the founder of Leadership Network, but also the founder of the Peter F. Drucker Foundation for Nonprofit Management. Bob Buford has often expressed his deep admiration for Drucker. Buford based Leadership Network on business management principles that he learned from Drucker. Following Drucker's strategies, Bob Buford only recruited leaders from successful churches as the first customers, worked only with those who were receptive to his goals, and only worked on things that would make a great deal of impact if successful. In 20 years of consultation with Leadership Network as a featured speaker and resource, Drucker's genius for business management caused the number of megachurches, over 2,000 attending, to grow tenfold. Drucker's influence was so remarkable on Leadership Network that Buford says the organization belongs partly to him.
Yeah, I think I had the opportunity to have the world's best mentor. The person, Peter Drucker, was the person that I most respected who was alive in my time.
My first introduction to Peter Drucker came through Leadership Network, and I was invited to meet Peter Drucker and Bob Buford and spend 3 days with them. Peter Drucker was the speaker. Bob Buford was the one who funded the program. And while there, I met a number of the professors from Fuller Seminary, as well as some young men who had been invited through Leadership Network and Bob Buford to come. There were a couple of our assistant pastors from Calvary Chapel that were there as well. Weren't sure what it was all about. Heard a lot about Peter Drucker and his systems management. I did not become involved with Leadership Network. I just met for that short period of time.
Apologist and pirate Christian radio host Chris Rosebro interviewed emergent leader Doug Padgett regarding the beginnings of the emergent church.
Can you tell us about what Leadership Network is and who Bob Buford is and that kind of stuff to start off with?
Yeah, Bob Buford is the funder and originator of a network called Leadership Network. So I was hired to create what they referred to in internal language there as the Young Leaders Network.
Got it.
And it was young in relationship to the other networks that exist in Leadership Network.
I don't think a lot of people really get this, is that you practically handpicked the entire crop of current leaders, both in the seeker-driven, purpose-driven, and emergent movements all by yourself. You got Tony Jones, Dan Kimball, Mark Driscoll. You've got Rob Bell, Craig Rochelle, you know, Andy Stanley, all of
and a bunch of women.
Leadership Network was really instrumental in helping to start Willow Creek as well as Saddleback. Am I correct in that?
Well, not the churches, but they were influential in helping them think about creating associations where churches could learn from their particular models.
Okay, so like the Willow Creek Association.
Willow Creek Association, the purpose-driven association.
Okay, and Buford, he was really tight with Peter Drucker, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, Bob and Peter were personal friends, and uh-huh. Peter Drucker, who's a management guru to some people's mind and a thinker on especially nonprofit management principles,
mm-hmm.
had encouraged Bob to think about investing his wealth in supporting churches, believing that one of the most under-realized and under-examined and under-resourced movements in North America in the 20th century was the advent of the large megachurch,
mm-hmm.
typically in suburbs and sort of non-denominational large megachurches.
He goes on to state that the Druckerites, Bob Buford, Bill Hybels, and Rick Warren, formed, bankrolled, and promoted the emerging church much the same way a music marketing company might form and promote a boy band like the Backstreet Boys or NSYNC. Rick Warren also endorsed Leadership Network organizer Bob Buford's book, Halftime, calling Buford a rare individual, and said, "I want every man in my congregation to read this inspiring story." Bob Buford reciprocates admiration to Rick Warren, saying on his official website, "Expect to meet changemakers. In the early days of Leadership Network, it was Bill Hybels and Rick Warren. Now these two have enormous self-sufficient teaching ministries on their own. As for megachurch pastor Bill Hybels and Willow Creek's role with Leadership Network and the emerging church," Bob Buford says, "The first foundation conference was held in Dallas and was the beginning of a partnership between Bob and Linda, Leadership Network and Willow Creek Community Church. Bob and Linda provided the vision and willingness to underwrite any shortfall. Bill Hybels and the music and drama team from Willow Creek provided expertise in designing messages that hit the heart through a very high-quality blend of the spoken work, music, and drama." Considering the loyalties of Rick Warren and Bill Hybels toward Peter Drucker, it is no wonder that they have endorsed and promoted the emerging church, a product developed by fellow Druckerite Bob Buford.
Bill Hybels and Willow Creek played a very key role in launching Rob Bell and his church, Mars Hill, in Grand Rapids, Michigan. When you travel to Willow Creek, when you go into their bookstore, they have an entire section of the bookstore dedicated to just about every single sermon delivered by Rob Bell at Willow Creek. You can purchase them. Every single Pneuma DVD video is available. Every single book, and it's featured prominently. The reason why you will not hear Rick Warren or Bill Hybels publicly say Rob Bell, Tony Jones, Doug Padgett, and them are teaching false doctrine is because they have a vested interest in the success of their products because they helped develop them.
Leadership Network also was a very powerful force in all this. When I would call on somebody or go visit a church or, you know, go to an event and I would say I'm with Leadership Network, people tended to know what that meant.
Uh-huh.
So it wasn't the Doug Padgett-ness so much as it was, the power of the position.
You had the clout of Bob Buford and Peter Drucker and the Willow Creek Association and the Saddleback Association all behind you.
Yeah, I mean, it was like, hey, the
those are people, I know who that group is. They write some good stuff, and they're, you know, they do some good things.
Implementing the secular business practices into the church from Peter Drucker, who was not even a Christian, will inevitably lead to destruction because it is making Drucker's humanistic model the foundation for building and growing the church, whereas the Bible teaches us that the church is built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Men can follow God's way or man's way in pursuit of church growth. May church leaders hearing this message be encouraged to follow God's way, since it is God's church, and Jesus said, "I will build my church." Certainly, Peter Drucker meant well in his quest for optimum community, but his worldly business management philosophies in the megachurch and emerging church movements have acted like steroids being injected into the body of Christ, causing unnatural, monster growth from which the consequences will be severe and fatal.
You can't talk community development without talking about churches and mosques and temples and synagogues. You just can't talk about it because they are the community. So my challenge to you is, can we not all get along?
What are the global giants in the world? What are the problems that affect billions of people, not millions?
The vehicle to bring about Drucker's vision of a new society is Rick Warren's peace plan. Warren unveiled his purpose-driven peace plan in Angel Stadium before 30,000 church members on April 17, 2005.
When he announced it first, they kicked off with Purple Haze, Rick Warren singing, you know, Purple Haze in My Brain, you know, Jimi Hendrix's song about LSD. Jimi Hendrix talks about how he was possessed and songs just came out of him, you know. And here we're singing a song, not me, but, you know, these guys are singing this song, Rick Warren leading with his band backing him, about Purple Haze and, you know, back to the 60s and that whole mentality of the Age of Aquarius. And here he announces his peace plan.
When I studied and read Rick Warren's Global Peace Plan that he launched at the stadium in California with the song of Jimi Hendrix's song, there was nothing in that song about the gospel. Why would you want to launch a global peace plan with a pagan or an atheist or where there's the lyrics of which have nothing to do with the gospel?
In introducing his peace plan, Warren said, "My hope is for a new reformation in the church and a new spiritual awakening throughout the world." Warren also believes that the popularity of his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, is an indication of this new reformation in Christianity. He stated, "I believe that we are possibly on the verge of a new reformation in Christianity and another great awakening in our nation. The signs are everywhere, including the popularity of this book." But what is this new reformation, this new spiritual awakening associated with Saddleback's peace plan and Drucker's new society? In 1982, Robert Schuller issued a call for a new reformation in his book Self-Esteem, The New Reformation. Then in 1999, C. Peter Wagner announced a new apostolic reformation in his book Churchquake.
But I want to remind you that the New Apostolic Reformation is the most radical change in the way of doing church since the Protestant Reformation. That's what we're dealing with. That's what we're springing off into the 21st century with.
Now Rick Warren is calling for yet another new reformation based on his peace plan to wipe out the global problems and make the church relevant to unbelievers. Rick Warren later changed the P in his peace acrostic from planting churches to promote reconciliation. For example, listen to his speech before an audience of Muslims who would have found the idea of planting Christian churches offensive. On page 48 of Brian McLaren's book, Everything Must Change, he speaks in favor of Warren's peace plan. McLaren says, "Under the banner of a five-point peace plan, Warren called local churches to participate in a second reformation. This first reformation, led by Martin Luther, Warren explains, was about belief. This one will be about deeds. It is about what the church should be doing in the world.
Many of you know Rick Warren, the well-known pastor from Southern California. And I was so impressed. You know, Rick wrote a book called The Purpose-Driven Life that sold, it broke all kinds of sales records. I don't know how many gazillion it sold, but it really has been incredible. It was an incredibly significant publication. Now, what would really be interesting when someone writes a book called The Purpose-Driven Life and they suddenly get huge amounts of money and fame and influence coming their way, then it'll be interesting to watch. How does the author use all that fame, money, and influence, you know? What you'll really see what his purpose is at that point. Not just what he writes about, but how he lives. And you know what Rick did with all of that fame and power and influence that came his way? He said, we've got to get people concerned about global crises. He came up with a list of five. If you know Rick, you know it would be in an acrostic, P-E-A-C-E.
Warren discussed his peace plan as follows. When Jesus sent the disciples into a village, he said, find the man of peace. And he said, when you find the man of peace, you start working with that person. And if they respond to you, you work with them. If they don't, you dust off your shoes, you go to the next village. Who's the man of peace in any village? Or it might be a woman of peace, who has the most respect. They're open and they're influential. They don't have to be a Christian. In fact, they could be a Muslim. But they're open and they're influential, and you work with them to attack the five giants. And that's going to bring the Second Reformation.
Do you want to work with us on poverty, disease, AIDS, illiteracy, injustice? I often find people are more unwilling to work with us than we are willing to work with them. In other words, we're saying you don't have to change your beliefs for us to work with you. If you can only work with people that you agree with, then most of the world you're ruling out.
Right.
Okay? I don't insist that a Muslim change his belief for me to work on poverty. I don't even insist that a gay person has to change their beliefs. They're not going to accept my belief, or I'm not going to accept theirs. But I just met with the...
When I'm out working on trying to stop AIDS, I'll work with an atheist. I'll work with a gay person. I'll work with somebody who totally disagrees with me. If they want to work on an issue, fine. Why? We're building a bridge.
Warren's peace plan includes unbelievers, Muslims, homosexuals, etc., setting aside differences and working together to fight poverty, disease, AIDS, illiteracy, and injustice. This, according to Warren, will bring about the Second Reformation. Thus, Warren's Reformation is a social reformation, rather than a spiritual one.
And so the Reformation needs to be about what we do, not what we say we do.
In conjunction with his peace plan, Rick Warren is promoting the three-legged stool, a concept introduced by Peter Drucker as a means to bring together different sectors in society. Drucker believed that the only way to persuade the world to accept change was to engage the public sector of effective government, the private sector of effective business, and the social sector of effective community organizations, including nonprofit faith-based organizations.
Over the last 2 years, I've spent a lot of time flying around meeting with every country we go into. We meet with the government leaders, we meet with the business leaders, and we meet with the pastors. We train the pastors, but we also meet with these other legs of the stool so that they understand they have to bring the church to the table.
There's a role for the public sector, there's a role for the private sector, and there's a role for the faith sector. Each of them can do something that none of the other three can do.
Can we not work together in building the three legs of the stool? For the last 3 years, I've been working on a prototype of this. It's called the Peace Plan, P-E-A-C-E. Promote reconciliation, equip ethical leaders, assist the poor, care for the sick, educate the next generation.
Peter Drucker, when he got involved with the mega churches, he came to recognize that one of the easiest things to put together, of course, as we understand, is a world economic system. And we're about there now. That's the easiest part of the stool to get together in a one world order. The second part is the governance of that. That's more difficult. And it takes the crises to develop that. And then you take advantage of the crises that is created. But the most difficult is how in the world do you get the heart of these people? My feeling, of course, is that third leg of the stool is the last leg to be developed, and that will be a religious leg, a religion that is man-made and not God-made.
If you are a global business leader, you need to understand that the future of the world is not secularism. It is religious pluralism. You may not like that, but you're going to have to deal with it.
Warren's Reformation has little to do with preaching the gospel, but much to do with all religions setting aside their differences in order to solve global problems.
The person over here who asked about the millennial goals, I met last month with Secretary General Ban Ki-moon to talk about faith-based organizations working with the UN on this. And later you should talk to Tony Blair, who's just formed a foundation. He's much too humble to talk about it on this very issue. To my brother, Islamic brother here from Italy, I would say, I'm not really interested in interfaith dialogue. I'm interested in interfaith projects. We got enough talk.
Notice how Warren's peace plan is distinctly different than Jesus' peace plan. In Warren's project, Christians and Muslims are equally yoked together in ministry, whereas Jesus said, "Do not think that I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law." Jesus' peace plan brings a sword of division between Christians and those hostile to the gospel, such as Muslims, so that a man's foes shall be those of his own household. This sword that Jesus spoke of was his word, and the gospel that would divide households once allegiances were made to his kingdom. While Warren's plan is seeking to bring about interfaith peace and world peace, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give to you." Jesus came to bring peace with God through repentance and faith in him, not world peace, as Warren's peace plan achieves. Just as Drucker criticized Christianity for being too individualistic, the church growth movement seeks to appeal to unbelieving people groups collectively. Paul Smith writes, "The Fuller School of World Missions founding dean, Donald McGavran, introduced a new theory. He advocated that missionaries should not make a gospel appeal for a response from an individual, but elicit responses from groups of people. This new missional theory appealed to unbelieving homogeneous people groups to collectively agree to abandon their old religion, identify with Christ, claim the Bible as their authority, claim the church as their religious institution. An entire people group or society being Christianized cannot be equated with individuals one by one being born again.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Whosoever believeth, it's an individual matter. It's individually coming to Jesus.
But in fulfillment of Drucker's lifelong goal of creating a new society through the megachurch, Time magazine reported, "Over the last 4 years, Warren has beta-tested his plan by sending almost 8,000 members of his own 22,000-member Saddleback Church congregation and an undetermined number from 12 other congregations to work in 68 nations. The flagship project has been in Rwanda, whose president has declared his intentions to make his country the world's first purpose-driven nation."
Simply called the Peace Plan, this ambitious effort takes Warren's purpose-driven philosophies to new heights. Rwanda became the first nation to sign up, thanks in large part to the country's president, Paul Kagame, and his unique relationship with Pastor Warren. This next step involves bringing the country's three sectors of society together to work on developing the country.
The component of faith and Christianity, government and business.
Success here means this peace model may one day be replicated in other countries. A possible goal is 68 other countries, and Saddleback Church has sent out nearly 8,000 members in small teams around the world.
I want to tell you, I'm more excited about purpose-driven and the peace plan than I've ever been, because I saw an amazing result
And I'm watching an entire nation being transformed because of you, Saddleback Church. The president was flat out overjoyed. I spent 2 days with the president's advisory council, which I serve on. I spoke to a national prayer breakfast to about 400 of the leading government leaders. There was great enthusiasm. In fact, they've asked me to train their leadership. I had private meetings with the president of the central bank, the governor of the central bank, and the prime minister, of course, with the president. And these men have asked me to do leadership training for that nation with the government because they've seen what's happened with our pastors.
This idea of a purpose-driven nation or purpose-driven country or purpose-driven society is no different than Emperor Constantine's intentions with the Holy Roman Empire. In the early 4th century AD, Constantine adopted the Christian faith for the entire Roman Empire.
Constantine declared that the Roman world is now Christian.
Christianizing a nation, an entire society, proved to be a fatal mistake. After Constantine's declaration, Christianity was mixed with the empire's existing secular beliefs and holidays, causing confusion which remains today. As Rick Warren launched the Purpose-Driven Living in Uganda campaign, the following press release also spoke of the purpose-driven country and the purpose-driven continent. Pastor Rick has partnered with the president and others to make Rwanda a purpose-driven country. I ask, why not Uganda as well? Archbishop Arombi challenged an unprecedented gathering of 450 national leaders at a banquet gathered to hear Dr. Warren speak. Uganda should be a purpose-driven nation as well. But it takes people of purpose to build purpose-driven churches, purpose-driven communities, and a purpose-driven country. Someday, we will have a purpose-driven continent.
You know, we told the Rwandans about our next goal. Now that we've gone to every nation, we're now going to go to the 3,800 unengaged people groups, these small tribes that don't have any church in it between now and the end of the decade.
While Warren's plan for changing and reaching the world are very noble, it is dreadful to think that the watered-down, easy believism version of the gospel is not only being spread all over the world, but now going to be proclaimed to unreached people groups of the world.
Hi, I'm Rick Warren, pastor of Saddleback Church in Southern California and author of The Purpose-Driven Church and The Purpose-Driven Life. I want to talk to you about something that's deeply embedded in my heart, and maybe it's embedded in yours. If you care about taking the whole gospel to the whole world in a whole new way, I want to talk to you for just a minute.
In an article entitled Rick Warren in Rwanda Announces Plans to Host All 54 African Nations at Purpose-Driven Church Congress, the Christian Post reports, Pastor Rick Warren announces plans for the All Africa Purpose-Driven Church Congress to be held in August 6th through 10th, 2015. The report continues, the conference will be the first of 5 annual continent-wide conferences to take place by 2020, with the second planned to be held in Latin America in 2016. This conference will be held in Rwanda, the first purpose-driven nation. Warren explained how the idea for the peace plan was birthed in 2003, but it became a reality as Rwanda became the first purpose-driven nation. Warren said, most nations are validated by their strength in exports. Rwanda can become famous for exporting leadership. Rwanda should be the leadership and innovation capital of the continent of Africa. That is why I am calling leaders from across the continent to come to Rwanda next year to learn. The strength of Rwanda is not in the ground, it's in the people. Rick Warren is pointing to Rwanda as the model for the entire continent of Africa. In other words, the country, which became the first purpose-driven nation, is now Warren's model for what he hopes will be the first purpose-driven continent. Pastor Rick Warren cast the following vision for the year 2015.
Now let me tell you about a couple of opportunities we've got coming up in our church in 2015, since this is Vision Weekend. Paul says there's a wide open door for a great work here. We have just been given a wide open door like no other church in the history of Christianity. An opportunity to impact an entire continent. Let me give you the background.
We started the peace plan about 10 years ago to promote reconciliation and plant churches, to equip leaders, to assist the poor, to care for the sick, to educate the next generation. Over the next 10 years, we sent out 23,869 of our members to 197 nations. Nobody has ever done that, ever, anywhere in 2,000 years of Christianity. This is the most global-minded church on the planet, bar none, bar none. One of those 197 countries was a little nation called Rwanda. Only 10 million people had been devastated by a genocide 20 years ago when 1 million people were killed. The president of that country, President Paul Kagame, read my book, Purpose Driven Life. And he wrote me a letter and he says, I read Purpose Driven Life. I'm a man of purpose. I invite you to come and help us rebuild our nation. Help us become the first purpose-driven nation. Bring the peace plan. Bring your training. And so while we were sending 23,000 members to every nation, we made a concerted effort to send 1,200 of our members to this little country called Rwanda. And we began to train them in everything possible to help them rebuild. We first started with the churches, working in and through the churches. Over 4,000 churches, 3,000, 4,000 churches have gone through purpose-driven training. Over 2,000 of them have completed 3 years of training. These churches are growing. They're caring for the sick. They're assisting the poor. They're helping educate the next generation. They're doing things that the government had neither the money nor the expertise to do. Now, when this started happening in Rwanda, I started getting calls first from other business leaders, other church leaders, other African leaders, and then I started getting calls from the presidents of nations. I've had 5 African presidents call me and say, when are you bringing the peace plan to our nation? And I said, well, we're not, but we'll send the Rwandans, because we'll train them to train others, to train others, to train others. So then I got the idea, well, what about instead of us going to them, why don't we bring them all in to Rwanda? So a month ago, I invited the top leaders of 35 nations, 31 African nations, and leaders from Russia, from China, from India, and from the United States, 35 nations, invited them to go with me to Rwanda to see this national miracle of a purpose-driven nation and the purpose and the peace plan. And we took them. I let them see how we work with business leaders. And I took a lot of them to see how we work with government leaders. And I took them and let them see how we work with educational leaders. And of course, I let them see, most of all, how we're working through the churches. The church is the center of the community. And every one of these leaders said, we're going back to our nation to plan a steering committee for a purpose-driven peace plan strategy nationwide in our nation. So next year, in August, we're going to hold the first All-Africa Continental Congress for purpose-driven leadership in Rwanda. They've just got a new convention center finished. And we're going to bring the top leaders from all 54 African nations together. And we're going to train them in how to do PD, purpose-driven, and the peace plan.
Notice this is not about bringing the gospel or Jesus to other nations, but bringing the peace plan to other nations. Working with business leaders, government leaders, and educational leaders has nothing to do with the Great Commission. In the Great Commission, Jesus said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you." Warren mentions assisting the poor, caring for the sick, and educating the next generation, which are all meaningful ministries. But he omits the preaching of the gospel, making disciples, and teaching them to observe all things Jesus commanded. Warren's peace plan is not a fulfillment of the Great Commission.
So in 2015, I'm going to host an all-Africa purpose-driven church leadership training conference in the heart of the continent of Africa in Kigali, Rwanda.
Unlike Saddleback Church, The church described in the Bible never yoked itself with government and business in order to change the globe through humanitarian efforts. The kingdom of Christ and his church is not an earthly political kingdom of this world. It is separate from the world and the affairs of the state. With worldly nations like Rwanda and Uganda becoming purpose-driven nations through the peace plan, the Apostle John tells us, "They are of the world. Therefore, they speak as of the world, and the world hears them. We are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error." James 4:4 declares, "Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God." Yet Warren's peace plan and new society envisioned by his mentor, Peter Drucker, is increasingly embraced by politicians, celebrities, and world leaders.
He was a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, which the Council on Foreign Relations is seeking to build a new world order. And at first, he just blatantly denied that he was a member of the CFR. And then later it came out that, yeah, he was a member and admitted that he is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. So his peace plan is very, very scary as it fits into this whole ecumenical movement, this whole God's dream, kingdom, dominion, new world order, and where the church is headed at this time.
Even President Obama sparked controversy when he asked Rick Warren to lead the prayer at the presidential inauguration in January of 2009. After Warren began his speech, he said these words,
"The scripture tells us, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. And you are the compassionate and merciful one, and you are loving to everyone you have made.'"
Warren appeals to the three Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. The first half of the paragraph, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one," is the Shema from Deuteronomy 6:5, the most notable prayer in Judaism. But a problem arises when Warren says, "You are the compassionate and merciful one." Yes, God is compassionate, and yes, God is merciful, but you won't find these attributes grouped together like this anywhere in the Bible. You will find them, however, consistently scattered throughout the Quran. In fact, 113 chapters, all except one, begin with, "In the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful." Other translations translate this phrase as "entirely merciful, the especially merciful," or "most gracious, most compassionate." Regardless of how this Arabic expression is translated, merciful and compassionate are consistently grouped together throughout the Quran and attributed to Allah, but never do they appear in this way in regard to Yahweh in the Bible.
Then you have Rick Warren at Barack Obama's, you know, inaugural prayer, doing the inaugural prayer, and he's praying in the name of Isa at one point.
"I humbly ask this in the name of the one who changed my life, Yeshua, Isa, Jesus, Jesus."
Isa is not the Jesus of the Bible. Isa is the Jesus of the Quran, which is a different Jesus, again, who didn't die for our sins and who is not God in the flesh, is not the Son of God. And then you have him also addressing the ISNA, the Islamic Society of North America.
"Assalamu alaikum."
Which just a couple years prior to that was designated by the Justice Department as a terrorist group or funding terrorism. And he doesn't give them the gospel. Somebody say, "Well, yeah, he came to preach Jesus to them, you know, and hey, you know, praise God. I'm all for standing up at the gates of hell and proclaiming the gospel. That would be awesome." But that's not what happened. He encourages them on how to be successful. Now, when you look at what Islam teaches about ultimate success in the Quran, is the domination over every other religion of Islam, by Islam, through the use of jihad, and if you're, you know, going out against your enemy and slaying him wherever you find him. And Christians are allowed to live as long as they submit to Islam and pay the toll tax, you know. Otherwise, they're persecuted, they're beheaded. So it's getting really sad as to where this is all headed, because these are the leaders of the visible professing church working with Muslims to bring this new world order about.
"I was asked to speak to you about how can Muslims
nations work closer together for the greater good in our world. And I will tell you that I'm not interested in interfaith dialogue. I am interested in interfaith projects. There's a big difference.
Warren gave practical examples of how Muslims and Christians could work together on his peace plan. Christians are to boldly proclaim the gospel to Muslims, that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in Jesus' name, rather than trying to find a common word with them or common ground in order to work for the common good. The gospel of Jesus Christ was absent from Warren's entire speech.
Now, dear friends, as globalization draws us closer and closer together, one of the most pressing questions we have to ask ourselves is, how do we deal with our deepest differences? It is a fundamental question we have to wrestle with. How do we live together in peace and harmony? And not only that, how can we actually work together, maintaining our separate traditions, maintaining our convictions without compromise, but working together for the greater good of everybody in the world?
In this statement, is not Warren essentially stating that the convictions of Muslims are fine and worth maintaining without compromise or being challenged? Jesus said, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Who is a liar but he that denies the Son?" Christ-rejecting Muslims are enemies of God. But Rick Warren believes they can contribute to the greater good of humanity?
We must say, with over 1 billion Muslims and over 2 billion Christians, together as half the world, we have to do something about modeling what it means to live in peace, to live in harmony. We need to join together to create some kind of coalition to end stereotyping. We will never solve any of the major problems of the world until you involve houses of faith. Mosques, temples, synagogues, churches, and so forth. There are 600,000 Buddhists in the world. There are 800,000 Hindus in the world. There are over 1 billion Muslims, a couple billion Christians. Most of the world has some kind of faith.
How can a Christian make such a statement? What Rick Warren is saying is that Christians need to join together with those who reject Christ in order to solve the world's problems. Jesus also said, "Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters." Recently, an article from the Orange County Register was published entitled "Rick Warren Builds Bridge to Muslims." It described how Warren is part of an effort named King's Way that is attempting to bring evangelical Christians and Muslims together. The Reverend Rick Warren, pastor of Saddleback Church in Lake Forest and one of America's most influential Christian leaders, has embarked on an effort to heal divisions between evangelical Christians and Muslims by partnering with Southern California mosques and proposing a set of theological principles that includes acknowledging that Christians and Muslims worship the same God. The news went viral on the web when many bloggers and critics of Warren responded. In anticipation of a second article from the Orange County Register, Saddleback offered a preemptive strike in Warren's defense, in which Warren stated, "A week ago, a reporter published an article in the Orange County Register about Saddleback Church that contained many errors and false assumptions. It erroneously stated that we have a partnership with a local Muslim mosque. That is false. However, the second OCR article confirms that Saddleback did indeed partner with a local Muslim mosque. In a February 10th interview with the Register, Tom Holliday, associate senior pastor at Saddleback, described the outreach to Muslims as a multi-pronged effort that includes sharing meals at mosques during religious holidays and working together with Muslims on joint community service projects. Warren continued, "It erroneously reported that our church had agreed to a theological document with Muslims. The document, titled King's Way, co-authored by Abraham Muhlenberg, a Saddleback pastor in charge of interfaith outreach, and Jihad Turk, director of religious affairs of the Islamic Center of Southern California, was presented at a December dinner at Saddleback attended by 300 Christians and Muslims. The Islamic Center of Southern California, the website for Turk's mosque, published a blog post entitled ICSC co-authors historic interfaith document that demonstrates the new theological position of Saddleback. It featured a photo of Turk and Muhlenberg addressing the Saddleback audience beneath a projection on a screen with the heading King's Way. Saddleback has affirmed that the photograph was taken at Saddleback, more specifically the Saddleback Peace Center. The projected slide says King's Way. King's Way describes a path to end the 1400 years of misunderstanding between Muslims and Christians by consulting the texts we each call sacred to form a basis that allows us the privilege to serve the needs of our community together. Nevertheless, Warren went on in his defense, stating, "It erroneously reported that we had agreed to not evangelize with Muslims. That is false." However, the second Orange County Register article notes, Tom Holliday, associate senior pastor at Saddleback, said the purpose of the effort was not to convert Muslims, but rather to work together to serve the community. Asked if the effort was done with Warren's knowledge and approval, Holliday replied, "Of course it has his approval. The very definition of partnership is working together, and this is what Saddleback is doing with Muslims to serve the community. The Bible says, 'Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever?' Amos 3:3 says, 'Can two walk together unless they are agreed?'" Jihad Turk, Kingsway co-author, had emphasized that Muslims agreed to participate in the Saddleback outreach effort because members of both faiths agreed our purpose is not to convert one another, but rather to work on ways to make the world a better place by breaking down walls of misunderstanding. The testimonies do not match up with that of Rick Warren's. Warren continues, "It erroneously reported that we believe Saddleback and Muslims worship the same God. That is false. A person attending the Kingsway meeting could easily have come to the conclusion that Muslims and Christians worship the same God based on the vague language of the document itself, saying, 'We believe in one God. God is one, and God is the Creator,' with support for each of these claims from the Bible and the Quran." David Shawn, Warren's chief of staff, told Jim Hinch and a Register editor that the story was factually correct except in its statement that Warren believes Christians and Muslims worship the same God. Rather, Shawn said that it would be more accurate to state that Christians and Muslims both believe in one God. Apparently, Shawn asked the OCR to publish a correction to the article but later withdrew the request. Warren has stated, "Neither I nor my staff had ever seen such a document until the article mentioned it. It wasn't created or even seen by us. Saddleback Church as a church was not involved." Obviously, David Shawn, Tom Holliday, and Abraham Muhlenberg, all members of Saddleback staff, all knew about Kingsway prior to the article being published. The public statements and photographic evidence do not corroborate Warren's defense. Amy Spreeman of Stand Up for the Truth published an article entitled, "Why is Saddleback Pastor Teaching on the Kingdom Circles?" which provides the context of why Jihad Turk is working with Saddleback. Saddleback pastor Abraham Muhlenberg spoke at an event in France in June 2012. In the diagram behind him, the kingdom circles are part of the session. The kingdom circles are a simple but highly questionable evangelical tool that people are being taught to draw in order to demonstrate how those of other faiths can enter the kingdom of God without converting to Christianity.
The kingdom of God. Or in Arabic, you could say Malakut Allah. Now, if this circle represents Christians, this circle represents Muslims, what's happened for so many years is that Christians have been telling Muslims, "You've got to come over into our circle, become a Christian. That's the only way you can come into the kingdom of God." Or Muslims have been saying, "Hey, come over here. You've got to become a Muslim. That's how you really know God and are able to move in the right direction." But really, those things aren't the issue. The real issue is how can we both move into the kingdom of God and find the straight path to God? That is the question.
A Common Word Between Us and You is a global interfaith initiative that began as an open letter in October 2006. A Common Word Between Us and You proposes love of God and love of neighbor as the common ground between Christianity and Islam.
A Christian response to the letter entitled Loving God and Neighbor Together, A Christian Response to a Common Word Between Us and You, was published in the New York Times. Some of those who endorsed the letter included megachurch pastor Bill Hybels, emergent leader Tony Jones, emergent leader Brian McLaren, self-esteem preacher Robert Schuller, and the purpose-driven pastor Rick Warren. The problem is that the document contains statements that allude to the false belief that Muslims and Christians worship the same God, that they share the same divine origin. The document states, "It is hoped that this document will provide a common constitution for the many worthy organizations and individuals who are carrying out interfaith dialogue all over the world. Often these groups are unaware of each other and duplicate each other's efforts. Not only can a common word between us give them a starting point for cooperation and worldwide coordination, but it does so on the most solid theological ground possible, the teachings of the Quran and the Prophet, and the commandments described by Jesus Christ in the Bible. Thus, despite their differences, Islam and Christianity not only share the same divine origin and the same Abrahamic heritage, but the same two greatest commandments."
Both of these documents that were written, one the Muslims wrote first, and then you have the professing Christian response, is about unification and that we can only be one if we agree that we're worshiping the same God.
In the summary of A Common Word Between Us and You, it states, "The basis for this peace and understanding already exists. It is part of the very foundational principles of both faiths, love of the one God." The Christian response letter also refers to God of the Muslim tradition, as if the Muslims worship the same God as Christians. While Islam claims to worship one God, the response letter does not address the profound differences between the one God of the Bible and Allah.
They signed the response that Yale Divinity School put back, which included affirmation that Muhammad was the prophet. Since they did not refute the statement that the Bible and the Quran are both of divine origin, they were affirming that as well. I believe it's the greatest betrayal in the history of Christianity by professing Christian leaders.
What's really just tragic about this is the Quran nine different times that Jesus is the Son of God. Denies it. Now, how can you deny the incarnation, God in the flesh, and deny that Jesus is God and say that we have the same God? How can you deny that God is triune? Deny Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and claim that we worship the same God. You really can't. And Muslims recognize, ultimately, that we have to deny the Trinity. In fact, the Common Word document is based on a surah, a verse in the Quran, which states emphatically to make a common word between us and them, the Christians, that calls the people of the book, and get them to deny or not to say that God is three or that God is triune. Now, think about this. You're having Muslims write a document based upon a surah that joins them to go to Christians to get them to deny that Jesus is God in the flesh, to deny the Trinity, to make a common word based on that surah. They call it a common word between us and you. Christians, professing Christians, write back, like Rick Warren and Brian McLaren, sign and agree that, hey, yeah, we all worship the same God, i.e. loving God and neighbor together, meaning we're loving the same God. Therefore, we can hope to have world peace. And it's compromising the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Though Christians may be in agreement with Muslims about finding common ground and not desiring strife, violence, and war, it is on the basis of the person of Jesus Christ that Christians do not kill. The love of God is uniquely expressed in Christ dying for our sins upon the cross and raising again, which Islam rejects. The Bible is clear that whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Muslims reject Jesus as the crucified and risen Son of God and Savior of the world. Therefore, Muslims are rejecting God. Christians and Muslims do not stand together on common ground or understanding of God or the love of God. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. While Jesus teaches to love one's enemies and be at peace with all men, Christians are not to set aside profound differences in the name of world peace. Any peace without Christ is futile in the scope of eternity.
And we put all these things together and we realize that 1 John 2:22 identifies Antichrist. And there are many Antichrists that have come and that will come again, but there's an ultimate Antichrist as well. Is a denial, that spirit is a denial of the Father and the Son. And again, this is the movement that we're witnessing before our very eyes, and we're seeing much of Christendom being swept up into it through the purpose-driven movement, through the emerging church movement, through the seeker-sensitive movement.
Nobody denies the need for social reform, but it is a shameful compromise of the Great Commission to replace the gospel with social, economic, and political reforms. Warren's noble efforts for global reformation will bring wisdom, discipline, order, health, education, and security. But it will not bring life. Indeed, it will keep countless from God's kingdom by deluding them into rejoicing contentedly over a refreshing glass of old wine. They will believe they have found God, but will only have been brought closer to godly principles. There is no life in the mere influence of God, only in His presence. And that life requires death toward all that the world loves. There are many passages in the Word that clearly describe what the world's reaction will be to the gospel, and how we will be treated and regarded because of the gospel. The nature of Rick Warren's program and message is defined by how the world reacts to it. Warren is reaching people groups with information, organization, ideas, and even inspiration. His team is doing many good works in Jesus' name. The enemy is happy to have us doing good things, so long as we do them without the presence of God. We will all see on the last day who truly knows the Lord. Indeed, the church growth movement may gain the world by compromising the gospel, but Jesus said, "What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels."
Beautiful. One more. Right here. You know, I have a million followers between Twitter and Facebook, so you just got famous just now, you guys. All right, how many of you follow Taffy on Twitter? Oh, you're sinners. How many of you follow Pastor Josh? If you're not following me on Twitter, you're going to hell. Okay, I'm sorry. I just want you guys to know that. So it's in the Bible there somewhere. I know for sure.